This is a production of SDPB.
Touchdown! This is for a state championship. Oh, direct kick, and it's good!
There's going to be some highlights coming off of this.
The short range jumper.
Edging out in lane four, the top seed.
This South Dakota High School State Championship event is conducted under the direction of the South Dakota High School Activities Association.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You are looking live at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, day one of the girls' AA basketball tournament for 2024. Along with Nate Keating, I'm Steve Toome. Great to have you here for the evening session of this Class AA girls' basketball tournament. Nate joining us here. Nate, why don't you tell the people who you are really quick?
Yeah, Nate Keating. I work here full-time at the Sanford Sports Academy and actually a former college coach of 14 years. And been here right at the Pentagon. I came down from my office, Steve. Very quick walk, easy walk. Excited for a great quarterfinal night session here of our state tournament.
And this afternoon, we had a couple of games that went down to the wire and similar scripts as we look at today's schedule here for the night session. Mitchell over here, or Mitchell playing Harrisburg. That's our first matchup, and then it's Brandon Valley taking on Spearfish. That will be the nightcap. Earlier today, O'Gorman ran out to a big lead. Rapid City Stevens came back, tied it up, sent it into overtime, but it was the Lady Knights staying unbeaten and advancing to the semifinals 64-58. And Jefferson led 24-9 at the break, but Pierre mounted a comeback, got within striking distance, but a costly turnover late sealed the deal, and the Cavaliers get out of the arena with a 45-41 victory. So that sets up tomorrow night with O'Gorman and Jefferson. That will be the first semifinal. Who will face off in the second semifinal? Well, the session tonight will determine that. First up, Harrisburg and Mitchell. The Tigers, they are coached by Nick Meyer, 13-8 on the season. They score 54 points per game. They shoot 39% from the floor, 60% from the free throw line, 32% from beyond the arc. And there you see they have played. Jefferson got a big win over Pier, and they also had a win over Rapid City Central. They beat Washington to the Sodak 16 to get here. Here's their starting lineup with Abigail Flanagan, Addie Wagner, J. Lee Hofer, McKinley Lawrenson, and Sadie Merman. We have three seniors, a junior, and a sophomore in that starting lineup for Harrisburg. And they are led in scoring by Flanagan, who's averaging 12 points per game. But they have a couple other players in double figures with Merman at 10.5 and Lawrenson at 10 points per contest. Their opponents tonight, the Colonels from Mitchell. Dave Brooks leads that squad 19-2. Coming into tournament play, they averaged nearly 53 points a game. You see back in January 20th, they beat Harrisburg 46-44, close game. They got a win over Jefferson as well, and they have a victory over Pierre as they were coming down the stretch. They beat Yankton 53-35 in the Sodak 16, and that gets them into the tournament against Harrisburg. The starting lineup, Lauren Van Overshield, yep, the former football coach, that's his daughter. Sawyer Stabner, standout player, averaging 15.5 points per game, first team All-State last year. Carson Weick, Addie Simpson, and Allison Meyerink. We have a couple of seniors, a couple of juniors, and a sophomore in that starting lineup. As you look at the comparison for the teams, again, they had a two-point game during the regular season.
Two very well-balanced teams here, Steve. Harrisburg, extremely deep crew. And then the Mitchell squad, a little bit less so, rely a lot on Stabner and Seamson to provide the scoring. I know they need to value the basketball. They're concerned coming in, talking with their staff about Harrisburg's size and on the glass, so that's gonna be also a big key to the game.
We're just moments away from the introduction of the starting lineups. We'll also have the national anthem as well, the presentation of the colors. Great crowd on hand, a great atmosphere here inside the Pentagon. This will be our home for the next few days here in Sioux Falls. Let's turn it over to our public address announcer doing the duties tonight, Mr. Greg Thompson.
Good evening. The South Dakota High School Activities Association welcome you to this opening session of the State Girls High School Basketball Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activities Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you'll enjoy the game and support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. Tonight's game features the Tigers of Harrisburg and the Colonels of Mitchell. At this time, please rise, remove your hats, and honor America and the flag of our country as the Sioux Falls Roosevelt JROTC presents the flag of our country. The members of the Color Guard, Cadet Colonel Emma Day, Cadet Major Hayden Klinsky, Cadet Captain Abigail Stapleton, Cadet First Lieutenant Zena Cannongator. And now, the national anthem will be played by the Bridgewater Emory Pep Band from Bridgewater Emory High School. Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem. And now, let's meet the cheerleaders for both squads. First for the Tigers. Kenzie DeHaven. Elsie Hagen. Addison Howard. Alexandra Yonke. Brianna McElroy. Lucy Cheddar. Caroline Wright and Taylor Zomer. Now let's meet the cheer team for the Colonels. Desiree Yamazaki, Kayana Thomas, Haley Gregory, Chloe Kershavel, Jada Stunez, and Caitlin Wellnitz. Supervisors for cheer team for the Colonels, Caitlin Clement. For the Tigers, Eve Langrock.
Time. It represents the past, the present, and the future, all at the same time. When you hear that it's state tournament time, what do you think about? Do you think about moments in the past maybe you think about one of the previous state championship teams. Or maybe it was the time your team came up just short and you can't shake it from your memory. When you hear it's state tournament time, do you think about the present? Do you think about the Harrisburg Tigers? Or do you think about the Mitchell Colonels? Or maybe when you hear it's state tournament time, your mind goes to the future. And time will tell who is left standing and celebrating with this trophy and leaving with these nets. Time can represent many things, but this moment right here, this is your time.
And now let's meet the starters for tonight's game in alternating fashion. For the Tigers at guard, a 5'7 senior number 2, Adlin Wagner. For the Colonels at guard, a 5'5 junior number 12, Lauren Van Overshield. For the Tigers at guard, a 5'5 senior number 4, Jaylee Hofer. For the Colonels at forward, a 5'9 senior number 14, Sawyer Stapner. For the Tigers, at guard, a 5'11 senior number 11, Abby Flanagan. For the Colonels, at guard, a 5'6 junior number 23, Carson White. For the Tigers, at guard, a 5'10 sophomore number 14, Sadie Merman. For the Colonels, at forward, a 5'8 sophomore number 32, Addie Simpson. For the Tigers, at forward, a 5'10 junior, number 20, McKinley Lorenzen. And for the Colonels, at forward, a 5'10 senior, number 42, Allison Meyering. The Tigers are led by Nick Meyer. Assistant coach, Dan DeBiggie, Brittany Rosberg, Haley Halling, and Mick Zeman. The Colonels are led by Dave Brooks. Assistant coaches, Mackenzie Mertens, Christina Simpson, and Wes Morgan. For this game, Darren Berg, Connor Singhuizen, and Matt Kemp.
Basketball here on SDPB3, along with Nate Kading, Steve Toom here. Harrisburg road, red, burgundy red uniforms. The home whites for Mitchell. Tip to the backcourt, and it's controlled by Mitchell. Looks like Harrisburg's going to come out man-to-man, Nate.
Yeah, that's going to be what their standard is defensively, and you're going to see a lot of them.
Swinging around. Colonels. Here's a shot. No good from the top of the key by Stabner. Stabner heading off to Black Hill State to play basketball.
And she's going to be a huge key for them tonight, as she's their heart and soul and what she provides.
Three is missed there by Hofer, but Harrisburg with the rebound.
With the length that Harrisburg has inside, forcing them to be one and done all night is going to be a huge thing. There they got a second chance opportunity right on the first possession.
That one rattled out there for Flanagan, spun around, did not fall. Just underway, evening session, day one. Colonels on offense. Here's the drive, the shot up and in by Stabner.
And there she is. She's a tough physical player, able to handle the contact and still go up and finish the bucket.
Stabner versus Flanagan. That's a great matchup there. That's two All-Staters going at it. That's what we love to see at tournament time. Shot no good. Somebody hit the deck there. That was Seamsma. The rebound to Mitchell.
And Mitchell's okay, you know. They're okay playing low-scoring ball games. You'll see them get into a lot of screen-to-screener action. A little continuity to start off with. Diagonal into a down screen or a stagger.
Drive, shot up and in. That was Seamson. 4-0 Mitchell right away.
Yeah, you get in these tournament games, Steve, and a lot of the times, who can get off to a good start, right? I mean, you get some jitters, great crowd, great atmosphere playing in a court that you really haven't, and being able to see one go down and just kind of calm the nerves can be a big thing to start off.
And we have almost a full house here inside the Pentagon. This is a great state tournament atmosphere here at the Pentagon. Harrisburg on offense, a drive, a wild shot put up there by Merman. Contact, but no foul. Mitchell comes away with it.
Yeah, it was a pretty good job of staying vertical, staying on their feet. Refs are letting them play here. We got a couple bodies already hitting the ground.
You expect that at tournament time, and here's a drive and a shot up, no good, foul. Two free throws coming up on the drive by Stabner. First foul of the game goes against Harrisburg.
And the one thing that Sawyer does tremendously on the drive is she's able to create contact while still staying on balance. You saw it on the finish from the left corner. You see it there on the baseline drive. Strong physical player, and she really utilizes it.
Lorenzen got the foul for Harrisburg. Checking into the game for Mitchell, Brianna Kirsch. She's a 5'5 senior, wears number 44. Also, Mackenzie Peterson wearing number 33 for Mitchell. The free throws are both missed. We stay at 4-0 as Harrisburg gets the rebound. Bringing in the front court, Merman. Wagner had it momentarily. Now into the paint, and Lorenzen outside. Timeout on the court on the turnover by Harrisburg. We'll be back in 1 minute. Mitchell up 4-0. Girls AA basketball right here on SDPB3.
We hope you're a fan of stories about heroes, because we'd like you to meet a few of ours. These folks keep our communities moving forward. They're dedicated to being here for you, navigating change, keeping you secure, and offering a helping hand to those who need it. Heroes come from many walks. Ours are here to walk with you. Go with trust. Go with people. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Welcome back inside the Pentagon. We are ready to go. 4-0. Mitchell up here, first quarter, along with Nate Keating. Steve Toome with you as well. Game number 3 of the day. Mitchell plays it in. A little bit of pressure by Harrisburg, but it'll back away.
Yeah, both teams right now picking up full court off any type of dead ball situations.
Top of the key. That's Peterson handling. Drive shut down. Ball on the floor. Are we going to have a jump ball? Yes, we will. Possession arrow, Harrisburg. That was Seamson that got tangled up there.
Yeah, great gap help by Flanagan there, stepping in on the drive to cut that off. And as a player, you really, and as a coach, frankly, you like to have seams in once you get, sees a chest, try to get that basketball out of her hand as soon as you can. And there you see the full court pressure.
Another jump ball, and this time the possession arrow to the Colonels. Again, side court to our left. And it will be White handling the ball. You see some left-handed point guards. It's like the third left-handed point guard traveling there on Sawyer. Slavery, rare mistake for her.
And they tried to put her in a little wing ball screen there to try to get her to her right hand. She's really, really dynamic when she's able to create a lane, create an angle, and get to the rim there. But Harrisburg did a good job covering up that ball screen action.
Pressure again. But this time it'll back away from Mitchell as Hofer handles the ball.
And you're going to see Harrisburg, they really want to try to play inside out as much as possible. There you see the nice drive and kick. Great extra pass.
Jaylee Hofer with the tray. Harrisburg on the board. Here's a three on the way. No good. Rebound tipped around. Controlled by Harrisburg. Foul. And that's going to be on Kirsch. And that is the first foul against Mitchell.
Van Overschild right there, just they were playing off of her a little bit, decided to test it in transition, and that's what she can do. She can shoot the ball at a really high clip, and she plays with a lot of confidence, and really as a coach, you like to see that.
Yeah, Van Overschild, 33% from beyond the arc this year. Hofer on the drive, no shot, foul on the floor. And it looks like that's going to be on Peterson. Her first, team second. Yep, there's the foul. No free throws. They'll throw it in. Oh, contested. Scoop shot, no good by Flanagan. Rebound to Mitchell.
Flanagan with a nice sidestep there. Point blank, finish in the lane, just couldn't convert. And you're going to see, here's Mitchell getting into a little continuity. Diagonal back screen right to the stagger. And they have no problem playing patient.
There's a shot that's blocked by Harrisburg. And they pick up the loose ball as Leslie Young-Setzer got the steal, or got the block. Coming off the bench for Harrisburg. Hofer's open, three, no. Tip to the outside, that's going to be a foul on Harrisburg. Bryn Van Bockeren, who just checked into the game, 5'7 junior, collects the foul.
Setzer bringing some good activity there early on. Contests the shot, runs the floor. When you have that big that's rim running like that, it can just suck your entire defense down, and ended up getting a quality look from three.
Yeah, and Setzer, she's a freshman, 6'1", and showing some hops.
Yeah, very, very good athlete.
Van Overschild, travel, turnover, Mitchell.
And Harrisburg really needs to get used to defeating screens and battling through screens, and there Merman does a great job. You want to try to get skinny with that, not run into the screen as much as possible, and arrive and provide guarded catches just like she just did and caused them into a turnover.
Wagner bringing the ball up, hounded by Van Overschild. Now Hofer handles it. Van Bockeren momentarily. Lorenzen. What's your thought about that three?
You'll see Harrisburg really. Van Bockeren was a nice take and finish. Harrisburg's going to be in a four out, one in motion system a lot, with Young-Setzer inside, and there are four guards playing on the perimeter.
Yeah, when you got a 6'1 rim protector, that can free up your wing defenders. That one well short of the mark, and Harrisburg gets the rebound on the miss by Stabner. Van Bockeren gives way, Lorenzen, no shot from the corner. Fakes the three, drives, got bottled up, in trouble, but finds the open player. Lorenzen misfires on the three, and we're going to have a jump ball, looks like. Possession arrow, Harrisburg with a minute 32 left to go in the quarter.
And that's the thing with Harrisburg's length and size. Mitchell needs to make sure when that shot goes up, they're finding a body, and they get five people there. You could see seams in rebounding down on the floor, and that's what they need when they're giving up a few inches at a few key positions.
Back to Young Setzer, and off the window, no. Clearing out the rebound, Stabner.
It's a good wall up by Myernick there.
And we're going to have a foul on McKinley Lorenzen. That is her second.
And when Stabner gets a head of steam in transition like that, she's just so difficult to stay in front of. We already talked about her size and athleticism that that she has, and they're going to look to her to be aggressive the entire night. She's had a few perimeter shots that haven't converted so far. Same thing at the line, but the basketball is going to be in her hands a lot, and they're going to need her to be really productive if they want to have success tonight.
That's her first free throw make. She was 0-3 before that one. We're tied at 5. Low scoring game here between Harrisburg and Mitchell. Stabner gets a steal ahead on the run out.
Great pitch ahead.
White couldn't get anything. Stabner in trouble, tipped away from her, picked up by Van Bockern.
Both teams just competing at a high level right now. You love to see it. State tournament action.
Tipped around, controlled by Mitchell. And I think we're going to have a foul, and it's going to be on Wagner. She was trying to go for the jump ball. They say grab the player on the arm. Foul number one on Addie Wagner, the 5'7 senior. She averages a little over 3.5 points and 2.5 rebounds per game.
When you have bodies in the paint like that, like Merman just saw, you really want to try to play off 2 feet as much as you can to give yourself some more time, be on balance. And they're an easy one right back to Harrisburg. And those are the unforced turnovers that, as a coaching staff, you really just need to make sure you're eliminating this time of the year.
Shot clock is off, so Stabner's going to check out. Or no, she's going to stay in. It's Van Bockern checking out instead for Harrisburg. They'll throw it in to Wagner. Young lady planning on going to Iowa State to study biochemistry.
Yeah, look for Harrisburg to just run this all the way down. Mitchell's extending their pressure out.
Here's a three. No, air ball, but Flanagan saves it. Still got time. Down underneath, Wagner, yes, her first points. Counted in the foul.
Second chance opportunities right now. We talked about it at the onset, but Harrisburg is doing a great job of sending bodies to the glass, and it's paying dividends for him right now.
Meyerink with the foul, her first. And it's the old-fashioned three-point play. 10 seconds left. Harrisburg by three. Stabner with a head of steam. Oh, got her defender to fall. Three, good! That's how we'll end. Quarter number one. We're tied at 8 between Harrisburg and Mitchell. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. You're watching SDPB3.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Oh my goodness.
Some of the fans enjoying the atmosphere here inside the Pentagon, the Mitchell cheering section. tied at 8, along with Nate Kading, Steve Tomb here. And Nate, what did you see from both teams in that first quarter of play?
Yeah, you love their defensive intensity right now. Both teams really extending out, trying to speed the other team up. And I think you saw some effects of that, which is some early careless turnovers. And the team that is able to clean that up here as the game, you get more comfortable, the game moves along, is going to be the team that gives themselves a good chance of having success tonight.
Looks like Stabner dribbled it off her foot. Out of bounds, it goes to Harrisburg. Stabner leading the way with 6 points for Mitchell. She's the top scorer for either teams. Wagner and Hofer each with 3 for Harrisburg.
And they tried to isolate her there on the right wing to try to get her to her strong hand. And Harrisburg did a good job sliding their feet.
Flanagan, one dribble and she's done. Now Hofer with the ball. Bounce past the outside, nothing there. Oh, off balance shot there by Merman was no good. Kind of a little out of control, and here's a breakout play and a score.
It's a great pitch ahead by Seamson and a great job of running the floor by Meyerink.
Meyerink heading off to Dakota Wesleyan to play golf and play basketball. I have heard of other athletes doing that before, so
yeah,
it's not unusual.
Yeah. Coach Christensen's going to love that athleticism and running the court.
A little contact there. I was calling games for Briar Cliff a few years ago, and there was a young lady that did that for the Chargers a few years back, played golf and basketball. I asked her, what's the difference? She says, well, in basketball, you better, you got to run wind sprints. In golf, you go play more golf.
Yeah, you go play
no
more
wind sprints.
Golf. Yeah, yeah. But, yeah, being out on the course sounds a little bit more fun than conditioning, Steve.
Well, that's how you get better at golf. You got to play more golf as there is a foul on the play. Looks like they're going to tag number 23. That's Weick in the inbounds play.
In this game, you really can't throw any type of habit passes. Like, when with both teams, is defensive pressure and playing up in passing lanes, you got to throw the basketball to their open hand away from that defender as much as you can.
Yeah, no lazy passes in this game for either team. Otherwise, it's going the other way.
You can see Mitchell just switching the ball screen actions, the handoff actions, trying to keep the basketball in front of them as much as possible. And Harrisburg's going to really try to jam that ball inside.
Flanagan, bounce pass underneath, and the ball was kicked. It'll stay with Harrisburg as they go to the bench. Tigers are going to bring in Van Bockern. And Merman will get a break.
Shot clock resets to 15 here in this situation with the underneath out of bounds.
Mm-hmm, on a kickball. And they go underneath, and Flanagan was fouled. Nice play on the interior. Foul on Mitchell.
Stabner just loses vision there a little bit. Flanagan did a nice job of cutting right behind her, sneaking right behind her, gets to the foul line.
Seamson with the foul, that's her first, as Flanagan, a 44% free throw shooter, misses. She averages 12 points, 4.5 rebounds per game. She is a 5'10 senior. Makes that one. Flanagan heading off to University of Sioux Falls to play soccer.
Got some athletes out on the court, Steve.
Yeah, we got some good multi-sport athletes out here for both squads. Vanover Shield gives way to Weick. And now here's a shot. Good on the three. Seamson.
And she can do that. You cannot allow her any type of space. She's got a quick trigger right on the catch. Comes off the stagger screen, gets her feet set, and knocks it down.
Mitchell opening up a 4-point lead. Flanagan lost the handle, out of bounds. It goes to Mitchell.
It's a great fill baseline there on the drive. Creates the turnover.
Timeout called by Harrisburg. McMeyer wants to rally the troops here with his team down by 4 and momentum on the side of Mitchell. Don't forget, you can follow SDPB Sports on your mobile device all season long. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Be sure to also check out all our action and award photos by searching for SDPB on Flickr. Tell us where you're watching the game from. Read some of our great stories and watch some of our videos that feature the teams, the players, and the coaches here in South Dakota. SDPB Sports. Hashtag SDHoops24. Look at the Mitchell cheering section there. They always bring a good crowd. And of course, Harrisburg brings a good crowd too. They didn't have far to go.
Yeah, both groups are supportive. Both boys and girls teams here in the state tournament here this weekend and next. An exciting time of the year for the students, the fans, the players, the coaches, everybody involved.
Love March in South Dakota as the pass is tipped around inside, but saved by Mitchell. Seems an almost lost it. Boy, who wants it? We're going to have a foul on the perimeter, and that's going to be on Hofer, her first.
Mitchell gets away with one right there.
I was thinking the same thing.
Yeah, the ball was a little stagnant on one side of the court for a large part of that possession and get bailed out.
5:20 and counting here in the quarter. Stabler had to fight through some traffic to get open. Meyerink. And whose hands it off of? It's off of Harrisburg.
In the last two possessions, they're trying to get the high-low action to Meyerink going inside, but Harrisburg Lawson doing a great job of working to the high side, making that pass difficult.
Stabner in trouble, left-handed shot, good. How do you stop that?
Tough finish by Stabner right there with the offhand.
Berman up court. Lorenzen gives way. Hofer, now Flanagan. Near steal, and we're going to have a foul out on the perimeter, and that is going to be on Van Overshield, and that is her first. 4:49 left until halftime. Timeout on the court. Harrisburg on top, 15-9. Back in 1 minute right here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting, SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great. Like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other. Lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
.449 left until halftime. Mitchell on top of Harrisburg. Low scoring game, 15-9. Along with Nate Kading, Steve Toom here inside the Pentagon. Day one, girls AA basketball state tournament action. Out of the timeout, Harrisburg. Boy, they got to find some offense.
Yeah, and they've gotten some high quality finishes, and they're again. They try to go right to Lawrence in off the side out, and Mitchell does a good job of reading eyes and picking off the pass.
Well, that coach, that just drives you crazy coming out of a timeout. And then that's going to drive you crazy on the other side as the pass was off the mark. Stabner couldn't get to it, so both teams trading turnovers.
And you're seeing it a little bit. You can just, there's playing a little bit too fast. And some of that is the defensive pressure. And some of that I just believe is when you get to this time of the year and the stakes are as high as they are, your comfort level just takes a while to kind of get in a groove and in a rhythm, and we're seeing that here so far.
Three by Flanagan, no good, and there's Stabner with the box out. Harassed in the backcourt, gives way there to Seamson. Ooh, she carried the ball. Mitchell has had opportunities to really extend this lead, and Harrisburg's got to consider themselves fortunate that Mitchell's trading some turnovers with them.
And those are the ones just of the unforced variety that as a coach are really gonna drive you to have no hair like Coach Brooks or some gray hair? And granted, he's been doing it for quite some time. So that's to be expected, I guess, Steve.
Stabner with the foul, her first. In the act of shooting, Lorenzen at the line, 59% on the year. Desperately needed point. That's only point number two in the period for Harrisburg.
Yeah, and it was a lower scoring game when these teams matched up, as you mentioned at the onset here in January, 46-44. And it looks like we kind of got a similar rhythm and similar groove so far to this game.
Both of Harrisburg's points have come at the free throw line here in this second quarter. They've only scored 2 points. Mitchell on offense. They find Stabner.
And you like to see the ball moving side to side, getting the defense swung.
Stabner's open for three, kind of almost shot-putted that one up there. And the rebound to Harrisburg.
Yeah, and right now Mitchell just doing such a good job in the half court defensively right now, and that's been a thing that they've brought the entire year. And there,
big three by Hofer. Yeah, that's her second tray. Desperately needed bucket by Harrisburg.
And she has led them. She led them the entire season from three. 43 threes coming into the tournament, and she can do that.
Yep, 38% shooter from beyond the arc. Van Overshield, and we're gonna have like a moving screen. And that's gonna be on Kirsch, and that is her second. Seen several moving screens in the earlier action today.
Yeah, and a lot of that is just, it's on the ball handler. It's on the ball handler to make sure that screen, if you're gonna make contact with it as a screener, you need to make sure as a ball handler, you're waiting until they pop their feet and you don't put your screeners in those situations.
See if Harrisburg can cash in. They're down by two.
Trying to post Merman there.
There's a three, and it's good, and that's Merman who steps outside her first points. And just like that, Harrisburg's got the lead.
Yeah, they were looking at her inside. Simple pin down screen. Great space and knocks it down. Seamson with the answer.
Teams are heating up now. Seamson with eight. Mitchell back on top.
Lefties can always shoot the ball, I guess, Steve, right? One lefty corner three, one lefty wing three.
And we're going to have a foul, and that one's going to be on Mitchell as Hofer hit the deck. Somebody ran through her. Myrink, her second. That was something that Coach Brooks says. We've got four lefties on their team. He says five if you count one of the coaches.
Oh, I love it. Yeah. I don't know what it is about lefties and shooters. The good Lord blesses them.
Flanagan. Or check that, Hofer at the line, and she makes her first free throw attempt.
Yeah, we're seeing an offensive outburst here the last minute and a half. They're getting, you can tell, both teams getting more comfortable, seeing the basketball go down.
Flanagan out, Van Bakkern in for Harrisburg. Tied at 18, 2 minutes to go until halftime.
In Harrisburg, Harrisburg is going to be comfortable going into their bench. They have a little bit more consistent depth than what Mitchell's played with for the majority of the year.
Another three, this one no good, and the long rebound. It's going to be out of bounds, and it goes to Harrisburg.
Right basketball play by Stabner there. Stopped two on the drive. Kick to Weick for a high-quality look. And those are the looks that you want to create possession by possession.
Hofer getting the ball. Chased by Weick into the front court. Ooh, near steal there. Pass, and it is back in the hands of Young Setzer, I should say. She'll get some free throws coming up. Fortunate break there.
Young Setzer does a great job of relocating off the penetration there. Has her hands up, pass gets tipped, still comes up with it. Finds her way to the foul line for two.
Van Overshield, her second foul. Free throw, no good. 38% free throw shooter on the year as the freshman. Leslie Young Setzer.
Yeah, her activity level here in this first half when she's been in the game, it's been impressive.
Yep, gets her first point of the night. Harrisburg up by one, coming up on a minute 20. Have to go until halftime. Shot blocked. Oh, what a great defensive play there. It stays with Mitchell. It was Merman who got the block. Let's check it out again.
Simple give and go right there. And as a defender, you like to see Merman jump in front of that cut so that pass isn't even made, but does a great job covering it up.
And we're going to have an offensive foul. Illegal screen. I think it was Seamson who got that foul. And that would be her second.
And you're going to see Mitchell set a ton of screens, whether it's on-ball screens, off-ball screens, and their continuity stuff. And I guess as old Rick Majerus used to say, one of the things he didn't mind was some moving screens. Make sure that your team's actually working to make contact off that. But when you get more than one, that's tough.
Flanagan misses. And we're going to have a rebounding foul on Young Setzer. Pushing off her first. Team's third. ...13 seconds difference between shot clock and game clock. Seamson into the front court. Looking down low, Van Overshield was open for a moment.
Harrisburg doing a good job defeating those screens.
Van Overshield
thought about it. See if they can finish the possession.
Throw to the outside. 3 seconds left. They're going to have to launch it, and it's good. First points of the night for White.
White with the nice pull-up jumper.
9 seconds left. Now down to five. A shot up. No good. Fought for, and Sawyer Staedtner is going to heave it the length of the court. And we are done with one half of basketball. It's been a tight defensive contest. And Mitchell up at the break, 20-19. Back in a couple of minutes with more from the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament right here on SDPB3.
Dreamer, doer, difference maker. These are just a few things we look for when growing our team at Dakota Bank. Those with empathy and a commitment to doing what's right build their careers with us. If you're about relationships and helping others, Dakota Bank is calling. Will you answer? Go with integrity. Go with teamwork. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our livestock, our pigs, is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Coverage of the South Dakota High School Activities Association event is made possible by a partnership between the SDHSAA and SDPB. Sponsors of SDPB's coverage include Dakota Bank, South Dakota Corn, and by Lloyd Companies, Bank West, South Dakota State University, the South Dakota Department of Education, and by your membership in the Friends of SDPB.
We are back here. It's 20-19. Mitchell on top of Harrisburg at halftime. Let's turn it over to Greg Thompson.
Here to present the Wooden Legacy Award are Nate Malchow and Jamie Parrish. This year's recipient is Larry Toft. Larry's receiving the award because he has embodied many of the traits that John Wooden felt were vital to success: education, longevity, character, service, and excellence. In 37 years of coaching, Larry Toft has put together an impressive resume. Three times he's been named the SDBBCA Assistant Girls Basketball Coach of the Year. One time he was named Head Coach Basketball Coach of the Year. And in 2017, he was a finalist for the NHSACA Coach of the Year for Assistant Girls Sports. Larry is a 12-time state champion as an assistant coach in South Dakota. In the final 22 years of Larry's career, he was part of 11 girls state championships and three runner-up finishes. 14 times in 22 years, Larry was on the sideline coaching in the championship game, 22 times. Larry was able to accomplish this level of success and consistency at two different schools under four different head coaches. Larry's part of the Sioux Falls Roosevelt dynasty that has been well documented in South Dakota history. In 2008, Larry moved over to Sioux Falls, Washington. The Warriors have not been in a championship game for nearly 30 years. Over the next 10 years, the Warriors would play in six championship games with Larry on the sideline. Ladies and gentlemen, my friend, Larry Toft.
Congratulations to Larry Toft. What a coaching legacy he has won and helped build winning programs there, Nate. All right, we're going to take a timeout. We'll come back. We'll have highlights and stats from this first half. Mitchell on top of Harrisburg at the break, 2019. Back in a moment right here. SDPB3.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
At Bank West, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. Bank West.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
This is the PBS app. It's ready for you whenever you want full episodes of your favorites. Perhaps a little history, or the real story, shows with heart, or the latest news and docs. Even stream your local station live. It's all there waiting for you. So download the PBS app now for everything you love and a whole lot more to explore. Stream anytime, anywhere with the PBS app.
Thank you. Halftime here, game number three of the day at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls, Class AA girls basketball. It's Mitchell, the number two team in the final poll, number two seed here at this tournament. They're leading Harrisburg 20-19. Harrisburg wasn't even ranked in the final poll, 13-8. But they have given Mitchell all they can handle during the regular season and in this game, and there's Sawyer Stavner getting things started, Nate.
Yeah, the usual customers for Mitchell stepping up with Stavner having eight, Seamson having eight, and that's those two have been huge for them the entire year, and they're showing it here tonight.
There was Stavner right at the end of the quarter knocking down the three as Flanagan fell down. The long outlet, Meyerink with the nice finish. Little turnaround there by Stavner. Triple teamed, I think she was.
Impressive footwork there with Stavner, yeah. Great composure, great patience.
The Kevin McHale school of how to use the pivot foot, if I can go old school there.
Yeah, and one thing with Harrisburg, they did a tremendous job. They had four offensive rebounds there in that first half, creating extra possessions. And that was something coming into the game that the Mitchell staff was really concerned with their size and their length, and they're showing it here so far.
Let's check out some of the team stats here. In the first half, Harrisburg 5 of 20 from the floor for 25%. Mitchell 8 of 15 for 53%. From three-point land, Harrisburg 3 of 10, Mitchell 3 of 8. From the free throw line, that's where the difference is. Harrisburg is 6 of 9, Mitchell just 1 of 4. So Harrisburg getting those critical points at the free throw line. Rebounding, 12-10 advantage, Harrisburg. Turnovers, 10 for Mitchell, 4 for Harrisburg. Another big plus there for Harrisburg.
Yeah, and as a Mitchell Colonel fan right now, you actually probably feel pretty decent with having a one-point lead after having 10 turnovers in one half.
Yeah.
And that's something where a lot of staffs and teams are trying to be around 10 to 12 in the entire game. And so that's something that they need to make sure that they're really cleaning up here in the second half, and especially those unforced ones that they're throwing out of bounds or traveling or carrying the basketball that aren't caused by the Harrisburg Tigers.
Give you an update from the A tournament. Looks like they are in the third quarter, and it's Sioux Falls Christian ahead of Hanson. About a minute to go there, 27-22. At the A tournament, Sisseton and Vermilion winning earlier today. At the B tournament, Arlington and Ethan advance. Of course, the B's being played out in Rapid City, so their night session just a couple of minutes away from getting underway out there in the Black Hills. Here we're getting ready for the start of this third quarter between Harrisburg and Mitchell. And for Mitchell, they had so many opportunities to extend that lead, to get a little breathing room when Harrisburg was really struggling on offense, but opportunity by after opportunity went by the wayside for Mitchell.
Yeah, their ball control, as we just mentioned, is gonna be a huge part of this second half. They're able to take care of the basketball and create some more offensive opportunities for themselves. They're good enough defensively to be right where they need to be, but that's going to be a huge aspect here to focus on here in this next two quarters.
Seven players for Harrisburg scored in that first half, just four for Mitchell. Backdoor pass intercepted.
And add another one to the tally there, Steve. Not exactly how you like to come out of halftime and start, but.
See if Harrisburg can capitalize. Hofer's going to be off on that three. I think it missed everything, but ended up in the hands of Wagner. No. Rebound. Stavner. Foul. Harrisburg.
Harrisburg trying to create the open look for Hofer, who had already hit two threes in the first half off a little misdirection drive baseline screen in, and she had a quality look, and they came up with another second chance possession but couldn't capitalize.
Bring it up as Seamson. And Overshield did not score in that first half. The only starter that did not score for Mitchell. She puts it up, but she gets her own rebound and throws it to the outside. Fresh shot clock for Mitchell.
And you are going to see with Mitchell, with how they play, they like to try to move the basketball side to side via the pass. They like to look for cutters coming off that free throw line screen, as you can see right there. So that was a good aggressive take by Stavner, just couldn't finish through the contact.
It'll be Merman running the show now, gives way to Hofer. Well, action on the perimeter here for Harrisburg. Now with a drive, the pass inside off a couple of hands. Last touch by Mitchell.
Lawrenson just diving, slipping right out of that ball screen, created the driving lane for to Merman there, especially to her strong hand. They just tipped the pass when she was trying to go back to her.
Hofer drives up and under and draws some contact and some free throws.
Yeah, great step through there by Hofer. Good poise, good patience.
Meyrink with that foul, and that will be her third. Yeah. Free throw missed.
And Mitchell, their 6 and 7 only played a combined 10 minutes in that first half. They're not an overly deep ball club. They really count on their starters to play a lot of minutes, and that's something to note and keep track of here in these next quarter and a half.
Tied at 20. Pressure, and it looks like we are going to have a timeout called to prevent a turnover. Timeout called by the bench.
Coach Brooks with the smart timeout there. They were pushed up against the sideline, 2-on-1, and that probably wasn't going to end well for them.
No. Hey, I'd like to tell you about Craig Maddock, who's out calling the B tournament. He has this wonderful thing he does for us called In Play. He has in-depth discussions about all things sports in South Dakota. And through these conversations, we learn about the players, the programs, and the legends who help shape the current sports landscape here in South Dakota. You can find In Play with Craig Maddock on Apple, Google, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. Be sure to leave us a 5-star review so that others are able to find it. 6:27 left. And Mitchell playing it in.
Harrisburg continuing to extend their pressure.
And Harrisburg has a lot of length, a lot of long arms on that defense. And there's a three that's up and no good. Getting the rebound and losing control of that was Mackenzie Peterson. She had good position inside, got the rebound, but just couldn't handle it.
Yeah, first offensive rebound for the Colonels on the entire game. That's not something that they're gonna do a lot. They generally really focus on getting back with their conversion defense, not allowing teams out in transition.
Finally go inside, Lorenzen scores! She's got three.
Did a nice job of sealing her defender off. Catches, one bounce, finished with that offhand. Great move inside.
And Harrisburg has the lead. And counted in the foul on the drive by Stabner. She's got 10. And Hofer, I think, got that foul. And if so, by my count, that's her third.
Just splits that gap, help defender. As Hofer sliding over there, you really want to make her try to kick that thing to the corner, get a chest on a chest when you're able to.
Free throw no good, but the rebound to Kirsch. Another opportunity. Check that second foul on Hofer.
Yeah, as Harrisburg, you really want to try to do whatever you can to take the ball out of Stabner's hands, right? Even if that means putting 2-on-1 and forcing a kick. See if some of these other secondary players can step up in big moments and make you pay for it.
Pass is shut down. And here comes Harrisburg. Nothing there on the fast break, so they'll have to back it out. Shot up and good. A three.
Merman left open. Knocks down a big shot, extends the lead to 5.
Well, I got one scoreboard that says 25-20, and one scoreboard that says 22-25. So I think it's 22-25.
22, yeah, with Stabner's finish. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Shot no good. And the rebound comes down to Harrisburg.
They got numbers with the drop-off and finish. Impressive vision by Holfer.
And a timeout has been called by Mitchell as they want to talk things over. A team timeout called by Mitchell. We'll keep it here as the Harrisburg Tigers are up by 27-22. As Mitchell's only scored 2 points in this quarter. And Harrisburg's looking like a different team. They're finding some offense.
Yeah, Hofer's just her activity level right now on both sides of the floor. Doing a great job of helping defensively. Has obviously knocked down a couple big threes in the first half. That was great vision on the drive, and that's really what you like to see when you're attacking hard to the rim like that, to be able to stay poised, stay composed, even if you need to decelerate, slow down, see what that defense is going to do and provide you, and they're just a little pocket bounce pass to a finish.
Great action in the last few minutes by Harrisburg. Update from Brookings, Sioux Falls Christian pulling away from Hanson in the third, 35-24. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toome. Great to have you here at the Pentagon. Great atmosphere, nearly a full crowd in here. We still got Spearfish in Brandon Valley coming at you later on tonight.
See what Coach Brooks wants to try to get accomplished here coming out of the timeout.
Mitchell 45% from the floor, Harrisburg 33% from the floor as a team. It's the free throws that are the difference in the scoring tally. Kirsch blocked by Flanagan.
Great job of Flanagan using her size, using her length. And I think you're seeing that overall. Harrisburg a little bit longer, a little bit taller at multiple positions. And here they are looking inside to Lawrenson.
Skip pass, Hofer fakes the three. Plenty of time on the shot clock. Back, Hofer, three, on the way, good.
Not the one you want to leave open. There they go. Lawrenson draws two. Mitchell sends the double team and they make them pay.
8-point advantage for Harrisburg. Their offense coming alive in the third quarter. Stabner, the drive, no good, too strong. Rebound, pulled down by Wagner. Harrisburg, all the momentum on their side at the moment.
With how hard offense is to come by, you feel like an 8-point advantage is.
There's Wagner with the good play to keep it alive. Fresh shot clock for the Tigers. Tapped away, but back to Harrisburg. Hofer, take that three. Nice quick passes, and we're gonna have a foul. And that's gonna be on Mitchell. That foul will be on Peterson, her second. Timeout on the court, 2:29 left, third quarter. Harrisburg up by 8. We'll be back after this 1 minute break right here on SDPB3.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour, you know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing, menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal.
All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
We're all going somewhere. Going higher, faster, farther. Going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring, keep making memories, keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
Out of the timeout, Harrisburg up 30-22. Along with Nate Canning, Steve Toome here. Nate, Mitchell's only scored 2 points this entire quarter. That's astonishing.
Yeah, offense has been hard to come by here so far in these first 5.5 minutes. And you have to give credit to the way Harrisburg is playing defensively, and they're really trying to do what they can to take the ball out of Stabner and Seamson's hands as much as possible.
Lorenzen, 5 points. 1 of 3 at the free throw line tonight.
And this trip to the foul line there again was created off a offensive rebound, second chance, and there you see Flanagan creating another one. Huge piece of the game so far, their 7th offensive rebound.
Flanagan drives off balance, no rebound, finally in the hands of Mitchells. They finally get an offensive rebound. White will run the show. And Overshield's been quiet tonight. And there's a foul on the approach to the bucket. 2 free throws coming up on the drive by Wyke.
Good aggressive baseline attack there by Wyke. And really at a much needed time right now for the Colonels, be able to see the ball go through and cut this lead down.
But a missed field goal, or free throw rather. Hofer, by the way, that's her 3rd foul. She'll have to check out in favor of Van Bakker.
You feel like with some of the leads earlier today that were minimalized at the end, that there's plenty of time, but you also with a low scoring ball game like this, and geez, just not being able to capitalize and convert to that, an 8-point deficit is something.
2 missed free throws there. Mitchell 0 of 3 at the charity stripe here in this quarter as Merman drives the lefty scoop. No free throws coming up.
Crafty read right there by Merman. Was going into the dribble handoff. Defender jumped way out, kept that basketball.
Stabner with the foul right there. That's her 2nd. Merman at the line, first time tonight. 79% on the year for the sophomore. Her brother, Jacoby, also a standout player.
Brother yes, we'll see the brother next week here in Sioux Falls at the AA boys tournament, and had a heck of the year for the boys, and the brother's going to be heading off to play at the University of Sioux Falls next year.
That free throw, by the way, was wiped out on a lane violation, so take that off the board. 9-point edge for Harrisburg. Mitchell just been stymied on offense. And there they get something. Seamson, she's got 10.
The C parts for Seamson there, driving in the lane and finish.
Only 4 points for Mitchell in this quarter. We're coming up on a minute 15. Oh, Van Bakker nearly lost it, and she did lose it. Kind of lackadaisical, went after it.
Great hustle by Seamson.
And it leads to a bucket for White.
She was first to the floor right there. First to the floor is going to win games. Love to see it coming up with the 50-50 ball.
5-point lead for Harrisburg. There's the drive and the bucket for Flanagan. That's her first field goal on the night. Lead back to 7 for Harrisburg. Down low, wide open. Seamson with a dozen.
Throughout the night, Harrisburg's been doing a pretty solid job of defeating those back screens, not allowing easy ones, but there the Colonels end up with a quick 2.
Shot clock is off. Shovel it along the baseline to Wagner. Tipped out of bounds by White. Broadcast colleagues covering the Spearfish game almost got a souvenir there. Fortunately, head up, hands up, and managed to keep it from hitting his face.
The dangers of the front row, Steve, the dangers. Gorgeous view down here, but you got to watch out for flying basketballs.
And flying players. I've been wiped out in this very position while calling a college game one time. Here's Hofer underneath, stolen away by Mitchell. That's how we'll end the 3rd period of play. Harrisburg 33, Mitchell 28. Back with the final stands in 1 minute right here on SDPB3.
Lucky for us, Life is full of choices,
big and small, just as it should be.
They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business, Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Harrisburg on top of Mitchell here, getting ready for the fourth quarter of play along with Nate Kading, Steve Toome with you here. Free throws, really, Nate, the big difference in this contest. 8 of 14 for Harrisburg. 1 of 7 for Mitchell at the free throw line.
Yeah, and they're really trying to do a good job of attacking the paint and put Mitchell in some tough spots. And as a Mitchell defender, you really want to try to force them to finish as much as you can without fouling.
Merman down low, Flanagan, oh, couldn't handle it, but manages to get the pass outside to Wagner. She was wide open.
Harrisburg tries to hit Mitchell with some of their own medicine there with the quick back screen and look.
Lorenzen with the rebound off the miss by Hofer. Now Flanagan, a three, and it's good.
It's been one of the big differences along with the foul line is the offensive glass right now, and one team's coming up with a ton of second chance points, and that's Harrisburg.
Yep. Defensive, that's 9 offensive rebounds for Harrisburg. Extend the lead back to 7. Stabner only 2 points, make it 5 now in the second half.
Yeah, and this is where this fourth quarter is gonna be where Stabner needs to step up and make plays, and that was a big one right there.
Here's a shot from the corner, and it's good, and that's Flanagan.
In the answer by Flanagan from the corner.
And a timeout call by Mitchell. With 6:51 left.
Looked like Wyke there had, they're helping her off on the sidelines. Looks like she's got a little, got popped in the face. And the Mitchell coaching staff, I think, maybe wanted the officials to stop the possession, I believe. And I don't know if they didn't see it, and they were trying to defend 4-on-5 there for a sec, and Flanagan made them pay.
Yeah. As the offense, which was sputtering in the first half for both teams, Mitchell shooting 50% from the floor, 13 of 26, 12 of 31 for Harrisburg at the moment. Free throws, 8 of 14 for Harrisburg, 1 of 7 for Mitchell. Rebounding, 22-13, advantage Harrisburg.
Yeah, and it's a direct correlation right now that Mitchell's actually shooting a better field goal percentage, but they just, with their turnovers and combined with giving up the amount of offensive rebounds that they have, that Harrisburg, the amount of opportunities and possessions that they have is the reason for this lead right now.
Points off turnovers, 15-6, advantage Harrisburg. Mitchell on offense, down by 7. Stabner steps back. 2 defenders right in the area.
Yeah, great job of Flanagan switching. And there you can see Merman cutting off. They're really trying to take away as much space from Stabner as they possibly can. And as we just mentioned, she's going to be a huge part of what Mitchell's trying to accomplish here in this the rest of the fourth quarter.
Foul is on Merman, her first. Again, team fouls reset at the quarter break. Got to get the 5, then you get the double bonus. Seamson drives, falls down, ball's loose, Flanagan has it. She's gonna slow things down, let the traffic pass her by, and set things up with Merman.
Yeah, and you want to be able to stay aggressive when you're Harrisburg, but also be smart, understand time, score, what the situation is.
Foul on Mitchell. That's on Meyerink. That's her fourth. Oh, check that, her third. Oh, they did. I was right the first time. I had her for three, and PA guy was wrong. That is her fourth foul. Flanagan gives way to Hofer. Lorenzen down low, kicks it outside. The open shooter is Hofer. A three's on the way. Good.
It's a great extra pass there by Wagner. Mitchell sends the double team just like they have been the entire game. Wagner goes one more up top, knocks down the three.
The number two team in trouble. They're down by 10. 5.5 minutes to go. Stabner gets position, finishes with the left hand nicely. She's got 15.
And they look to extend their pressure here, and they need to make this a higher percentage or higher possession game here. Seams in with active hands on the sideline.
And they're going to bring White back in with the Colonels, and Meyerink with her four fouls has to go to the bench. 5:19 left. Harrisburg up by 8.
And Jaylee Hofer just been absolutely huge tonight. 4 for 7 from 3, just stepping up, knocking down open shots.
There's a steal by Mitchell. Great play along the baseline. That was Seamson. See if the Colonels can cash in on the Harrisburg turnover. Harrisburg staying man-to-man. Simpson has the taller player guarding her. See if she'll try to work one-on-one. Pass down low, out of bounds. It goes to Harrisburg. Timeout on the court, 4:38 left. 41-33. Harrisburg on top, back in 1 minute with more girls AA basketball action on SDPB3.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
.438 left to go, fourth quarter of play. The number two team, Mitchell, down by 8 to the seventh seed Harrisburg Tigers. Along with Nate Kading, Steve Toom here with you. These two teams, when they played in the regular season, Mitchell won by 2. It was one of those ball games that could have gone either way. Still a long way to go in this one.
As you saw in our first two games today, that no lead is too safe.
Yep. Big deficits overcome, but unfortunately for the teams that were trailing, they fell in both contests. Hofer again, another three.
The basket's looking like the Atlantic Ocean right now to Hofer. Anything she's throwing up, she's feeling really good about right now.
She had an opening and she took advantage. Only four players have scored for Mitchell tonight. That three off the mark. Good box out by Wagner.
And Mitchell needs to find a way to create some extra possessions, keep the defensive pressure on, see if they can create some offense with their defense.
Yeah, for Mitchell, their comeback has to start with some defense. Here's a three by Flanagan. Good! 15 points in the quarter for Harrisburg, all from beyond the arc.
And Flanagan, who started a little silent today, having a big second half, stepping up, leading scorer for the Harrisburg Tigers. It's been a lot of her and Hofer here this second half.
Statner keeps the dribble alive. Reverse layup, counter, and the foul. Big basket there by Mitchell.
Yeah, and Statner loses her balance, gets back on her feet, and she's the heart and soul of what this year has been like for Mitchell. And all the way to the buzzer, she's going to be competing at a high level.
Lorenzen got her third foul. Still 11-point lead for Harrisburg at 47-36. Now, if you're Harrisburg, you don't necessarily want to shut down the factory just yet. Kick ball, it'll stay with Harrisburg.
Hofer there trying to repeat what she did here in the third quarter with that pocket drop off to Lawrenson, but Mitchell deflects it. Yeah, and you mentioned it. When you get to this point in the game, you want to be really smart.
And Myrick might have just fouled out of the game.
And you can tell that this
wasn't on her, it was on Stabner. That's her third.
It was an absolute priority for Harrisburg tonight is to play inside out, to jam that basketball down into Lawrenson as much as they can and play out of it. A lot of the game, a lot of tonight, Mitchell's been sending multiple defenders, and sometimes when she's able to go quick before that extra defender gets there, good things have happened.
Second free throw is good. She's got 6 points on the night. And the lead is a dozen.
Yeah, it's got to be Stabner time right now. And
Van Overshield misses on the three, and the rebound to Merman. Mitchell pressing in the backcourt, and whoever gets the rebound. Hofer spins away from trouble. Again, Harrisburg can afford to be patient. You don't want to be too patient. Right now, the clock is the enemy of Mitchell. Oh, bullet pass down low to Wagner, throws it up, and somehow it goes in as she was able to collect herself in the paint, surrounded by taller players. Timeout called by Mitchell. Harrisburg fans rising to their feet as their team's up by 14 points with 2:08 left to go.
It's a tough deal when you're guarding for 20, 25 seconds and they still end up capitalizing with a layup. It can be back-breaking when you're trying to mount a bit of a comeback right there. And as you mentioned, your time's your biggest enemy. And then when they're able to score two more, it feels like a lot to overcome.
Yeah, I think that's such a breaker of spirits when you play, like I said, hard defense for 25, 30 seconds, and then they somehow get it to go in. And on the other side, man, you are pumping your fist and you got that adrenaline flowing because not only did you score, but you whittled time off the clock. And yeah. And you've coached for a number of years, and that sometimes for younger players, hey, when you're ahead, the clock is the other team's enemy, and you got to capitalize on that fear because then they start pressing a little bit. Maybe they get some fouls and send you to the free throw line. You know, it's a mental game. And if you play smart basketball, you can really, really, you know, just put another team away when you get in a lead in a situation like this.
And it's been impressive to see Harrisburg 15 assists on the night. They've done an excellent job of moving the ball to the open person.
Stabner will get that one to go. She's had a Herculean effort tonight, but her team's down by a dozen, and there's Myring with a big play, and she's got four fouls. Seamson, yes. Mitchell's not done yet. Not by a long shot. The lead is 9, and Hofer was bumped into the front court by Seamson, and that'll be her second foul. But Mitchell's got a couple fouls to give yet, so that means with a minute 43 left, I mean, they got to play tough defense, but that allows them also to take some chances.
No question. Yeah, you want to be aggressive here. Oh, and another deflection and steal.
Oh, but then she lost it. And everybody's falling all over the place, and I think they're going to get a foul on Stabner. Yes, they will. Kind of inadvertent trip, but that's her fourth personal foul, and that's a big one. And now Nick Meyer, he wants to talk things over. This team up by a minute 38, and boy, Stabner made a play there, but then lost the handle. And
yeah,
boy,
she
that's
was,
such a baby kind of got a little too far out in front of herself.
Well, yeah, she was trying to bust it out. I think she actually dribbled it off one of the Harrisburg players' foot, just an inadvertent kick ball that they're going to let play through.
Yeah.
And yeah, Harrisburg fortunate on that one, because that was either going to wind up in a layup or a wide open three.
Just again, a heartbreak play there for Mitchell. They're down by three possessions, and they had an opportunity there with their best player with the basketball in her hands, but just couldn't quite up with it. Stabner, by the way, with 20 points so far, an 8 of 14 shooting. Seamson with 15. Meanwhile, it's Hofer with 18, Flanagan 11, the top two scorers for Harrisburg. But again, Mitchell's only had four players score tonight. Harrisburg has gotten contributions scoring-wise from more sources as you take a look at the team stats at this juncture.
Yeah, and even coming into this game, when you looked at the per season stats, I mean, Harrisburg was extremely balanced. They had different weapons step up, and Mitchell's, they've ridden kind of their horses the entire year, and both of them have stepped up tonight, with Stabner having 20 and Seams in 15. It really comes down to the foul line and turnovers and second shots here so far tonight.
Hofer's gonna try to dribble the clock out, and Harrisburg does have the full shot clock to work with.
Yeah, and this is where you gotta step up your pressure right now and make sure we're taking some chances, staying aggressive, and there.
Ooh, almost an opportunity for Mitchell.
And then when the clock clicks down, now that's at 13, 14, you wanna make sure you're just trying to guard, finish the possession.
A backbreaker by Hofer. She's got 21. That may have been the dagger, Nate.
She has just been on fire here tonight, on fire, especially in the second half.
And a timeout called smartly there by Seamson as they were out of control. But that three may have been the final nail in the coffin for Mitchell, as they're down by a dozen with 53 left.
Oh, and you can just kind of sense it. They're still competing, still playing hard, but it's key. You got to give a lot of credit to Harrisburg here in the second half. And when they've had opportunities, they've made them pay and capitalize, and Hofer, and they've played. They've played a really solid and clean second half.
Points off turnovers, 18 for Harrisburg, 9 for Mitchell. But here's another key stat. Rebounds, 24 for Harrisburg, 13 for Mitchell. Harrisburg owning the glass.
Yeah, and in talking with the Mitchell coaching staff coming into the night, the first two things they said were, we need to make sure that we're limiting turnovers, and we need to be able to rebound with them. And it just, it hasn't happened here so far yet tonight.
10 of 23 pointers, but 9 of 16 at the line. Meanwhile, Mitchell has hurt themselves, 2 of 8 at the free throw line. And it will be Mitchell to play it in.
Yeah, time is just so important right now. You gotta try to get a quick two, quick three, just something as fast as you can. Get right in your full court pressure.
Pass is tipped and intercepted, Lawrenson. And now Merman is gonna pick up her dribble, and a timeout has been called by Harrisburg, with 41.7 seconds left to save the possession. Harrisburg, they'll have two timeouts left. Mitchell, they are out of timeouts. 14 fouls on Mitchell. So the next foul on Mitchell will send Harrisburg to the free throw line for two opportunities, the double bonus. Harrisburg just two team fouls, as their fans, the Harrisburg Tiger fans, are standing, and they got to be feeling pretty good about their chances. Up by a dozen with 41.7 seconds left. Waiting in the wings, Brandon Valley and Spearfish. This game was 8-8 after the first quarter of play, a low scoring game. 1 point edge for Mitchell at the halftime. But Harrisburg outscored Mitchell 14-8 in that third quarter, and so far 20-13 the scoring edge for Harrisburg in this fourth quarter of play. Full court pressure being applied by Mitchell. They desperately need to force a turnover. They'll get it into Merman in the corner, dangerous, and a foul quickly, and that will be on White, number 23. Stabner was there. She has four fouls. That's White. That's only her second. And now it's the double bonus time for Harrisburg. As a team, 60% on the year. Merman, 79%. She's one of one on the night. But missed that one. 79% on the year. Had one wiped out earlier on a lane violation that she did make. But she missed them both. And the rebound to Mitchell. Ahead, Van Overshield, the long three, no. Rebound, and a couple of players fought for it from Harrisburg. And a Mitchell player jumps in there. And it looks like we're gonna have a foul on Mitchell. And that's Van Overshield, and that is her third personal foul. Merman back to the line, where she is one of three on the night. 7 points overall. Makes that one. The lead now 13 points. Shot clock is off. 9 for Merman on the night. She's played a great game. She'll get a break as Lindsay Worth checking in. She's one of the team captains, a senior who's going to Notre Dame to study business. Congratulations to that young lady for getting into that institution. And here's a three from the corner. It misses everything, and the rebound comes down to Harrisburg. They're going to apply some pressure and find finally a foul in the backcourt. And that's going to be on Seamson, and that is her third. And now Flanagan goes to the line. What a second half for her. At 1 point, that's all she had at halftime. So that free throw is no good. She's a 44% shooter. But Flanagan, 10 points in the second half, including 3 three-pointers in this quarter of play. That gives her a dozen. 10 seconds to go. Stavner's going to fire a three, and that misses everything and out of bounds. 6.9 seconds left. They'll inbound it. They don't even need to get it across the timeline, but there will be a foul. And see who that's going to be on. I think it's Seamson. If so, it's her fourth. And right now, Flanagan just get a chance to add to her scoring total with 2 free throw opportunities. Misses that one off the front of the rim. Here comes some reserves in. That one is good for Flanagan. And the bench will be cleared for Harrisburg. They will bring in Maya Johnson, Macy Brandt, Jada Mason also checking in for Harrisburg for the final 4 seconds. As Stabner up the court, she'll fire one last three. It's no good, and that's your final score. 57-41. Our first upset here at the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament, as Harrisburg knocks off the number 2 seed and the number 2 team in the final poll. Mitchell falls for just the third time this year. 57-41, the final score, as Harrisburg improves to 14-8. Mitchell is now 19-3 on the season. Stadner with 20 points. Seamson with 15, top scores for Mitchell. It was 21 for Hofer, 13 for Flanagan, leading the way for Harrisburg. Let's send it down to the sidelines. Nick Kading standing by with head coach Nick Meyer. Just a moment, try to fix up our audio problems right here on SDPB3.
As much as you have accomplished, there are times you'd rather not go it alone. While you determine what direction you go, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with community. Go with neighbors. Go with understanding. Go with support.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation, so we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
I decided to switch my major. I didn't want to do sports anymore, so I decided Southeast Tech would be a good one for me to go. The current instructor is a captain with the Highway Patrol. He had a lot of experience and knowledge about the job. I serve the people just as much as they serve me.
SDPB brings you the South Dakota Boys State Basketball Tournament. You can catch all the action Thursday, March 14th through Saturday, March 16th. For more information, including multiple ways to watch the games live, go to sdpb.org/basketball. Complete coverage of the South Dakota Boys State Basketball Tournament is brought to you by Dakota Bank and SD Corn.
And welcome back here as our first upset of the tournament sees number 7 Harrisburg knock off number 2 Mitchell, 57-41. That is your final score, along with Nick Kading, Steve Toom here. And Nate, you had a chance to talk with Nick over there at the sideline. What did he say to you there in the post or in their interview?
Yeah, he absolutely loved their defensive activity. Obviously forcing Mitchell into 16 turnovers on the night, and the ability that happened for them to be able to create offense on the other end was huge for them. And then credited their ball movement, thought they cut extremely hard off screens, and Hofer a lot of the times was the one ending those possessions, but he really liked how they were sharing the basketball when they drew two, especially inside. They were kicking out and making Mitchell pay.
Look at the field goals. How often do you see that? 17 of 36 for both teams, but the next three lines, actually the next four lines, are all the difference. 10 of 20 for Harrisburg from three-point land compared to 5 of 18 for Mitchell. free throws, 13 of 24. Not great for Harrisburg, but not bad either. But Mitchell, 2 of 8 at the charity stripe tonight. And the rebounding battle was huge. Nearly 2-1 in favor of Harrisburg over Mitchell. That is stunning.
Yeah, yeah. You look at the three-point discrepancy, but really, one team did a great job of controlling the paint and keeping the basketball out of the paint. And that was Harrisburg, because a lot of the times their threes that they were ending up getting were because that ball went inside first, whereas on the other end of the floor, Mitchell was just, they were really struggling to get much going at the rim and didn't get to the foul line because of it.
Absolutely. And normally Mitchell does get to the free throw line quite frequently. Second half highlights. There you see Stabner getting a rebound there. Lorenzen, the nice finish with the left hand. She really controlled the paint, the number 20 for Harrisburg, as Stabner did everything she could. But the three-point ball, Merman getting that one there. That was a big one. The drive, Flanagan missed it, tipped around. That was a rebound there after a couple of opportunities for Harrisburg. The nice outlet here. That was on a hustle play that Mitchell got that basket, but here's Flanagan. Bingo from three. Another three. Flanagan, yes, from the corner this time. Hofer, what a game for that young lady, as she led the way with 20 points, 21 actually, on the night, and the threes were raining in the second half. Flanagan again.
And as you can see, all those just feet set quality looks, and that came off their ball movement and still attacking the paint, whether it was off dribble penetration or whether it was off post touch. Those are horse shots, high quality horse shots with your feet knocked down, and you feel good about those as a shooter and as a coach.
16, the margin of victory for Harrisburg tonight. Let's take a timeout. We'll come back and we'll start getting you ready for our last game. Brandon Valley Spearfish. More action to come right here on SDPB3.
Our teams are committed to improving quality of life in our communities. Whether we're planning construction concepts, building a new downtown development, bringing new businesses to our communities, or maintaining your apartment home. We believe everyone deserves a well-built and well-managed place to live and work. This is Lloyd.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do. And that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yum! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
And we welcome back to the Sanford Pentagon Heritage Court, site for the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament for this year. Three games in the books, and now we move on to the nightcap. Number 3 seed Brandon Valley taking on this team, the Spearfish Spartans, a team that hasn't been at a girls basketball tournament since 2004. It has been a while for the Spartans. 14-6 on the regular seasons. They've got wins over Stevens, Harrisburg, who we just saw, and Brookings. They beat Aberdeen Central quite handily in the Sodak 16 round, and then moves him on here to the state tournament. That game, by the way, against Aberdeen Central, I believe, was tied at halftime, but Spearfish ran away from them in the second half. Sophie Guthmiller, Josie Dana, a couple of starters, along with Addie Reiners, Kate Sharp, and Mariah Bowman. That's the starting lineup. A senior, a couple seniors, or actually three, I should say, a junior and a sophomore. Dana Lee has 10.5 points per game. This is a very balanced team for Spearfish, and they also bring some big scoring punch off the bench with Maya Kochinen. She is a junior. She averages 10 points off the bench for the Spearfish Spartans under head coach Dakota Johnson. They average nearly 59 points per game. They like to get up and down the court, and they put a lot of points on the board game.
Yeah, and they really, really have some girls that can shoot the basketball at a high clip. Number 10, Josie Dana, coming in 30 makes. You got Kate Scarf, 36 makes. And then Maya, as you talked about, 28 makes. A little contrast in styles, where Brandon Valley certainly have some young ladies that are capable of knocking down shots, but don't rely on the three-point ball quite as much as Spearfish.
Will be interesting to see the Spartans in action, since, well, we haven't seen them at a state tournament in 20 years. Their opponents, the Brandon Valley Lynx, will take a look at them after this timeout. You're watching Class AA Girls Basketball right here on SDPB3.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
At BankWest, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. BankWest.
Established in 1986, the Great Plains Tribal Leaders Health Board represents 18 tribal communities located in South Dakota, North Dakota, Nebraska, and Iowa. Our vision is that all tribal nations, communities, and citizens achieve optimal wellness through the embrace of traditional cultural values and innovative and holistic healing practices, strengthened by tribal sovereignty. For more information on our grant programs, health services, and career opportunities, visit our website at greatplainstribalhealth.org.
The way humans make sense of the world is through stories.
We've got to go ahead and start training to go to Mars.
And lift off.
We pay tribute to all who serve and who have served.
Civilization is precious. Life is precious.
Artists here are making a difference.
I'm trying to seek redemption.
Inside the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls, getting ready for our fourth quarterfinal game of the day. The nightcap features Spearfish against the Brandon Valley Lynx. Mike Zur is their head coach. And Brandon Valley, boy, they've had a run over the last few years in girls basketball. This team, they're always one of those dangerous teams. They're going to be a stumbling block for anybody seeking a championship.
Yeah, and they have a bunch of these young ladies that were a part of kind of a disappointing upset last season, getting knocked off in the Sodak 16, actually by Mitchell. And they were determined this year and took a few games to kind of get their rhythm and figure out how they were going to play. But over these last 2.5-3 months, they've been playing as one of the better teams in the state.
Yep, they average 55 points per game, 40% from the floor. 17-4 is their record for the Brandon Valley Lynx. Let's meet their starting lineups with Olivia Padgett, a sophomore at a guard, Ava Kellenberger, Madison Giever, Paisley Hoff, Kennedy Deckard. And if that last name Deckard is familiar, it should be.
Yeah,
Brent Decker's daughter.
No question.
And she is a senior as you take a look. Brandon Valley number three in the final poll. Spearfish was receiving votes in the final poll. And again, the last time the Spartans were here was a long time ago. So it's great to have the Spearfish Spartans back in a state tournament. Brandon Valley, like I said, they've been here many, many times in the past. As we get ready for our final contest of the day, the winner gets Harrisburg tomorrow night in the semifinals. What do you see styles-wise before we get to our introductions?
Yeah, we talked about it a little bit, that Spearfish relies on the three-point shot a lot. So that's going to be a key for Brandon Valley to make sure they're covering up on their shooters, be sure they're locating them, force them into contested looks if they're getting any looks, and also put the ball on the deck and be able to make them do some things that they're not maybe super comfortable with. And on the other side, Brandon Valley, they got a nice mix of some younger kids. Olivia Pageant leads them in scoring on the year. Talented player that can frankly score from all three levels. They got some size with Giever inside. Very talented offensive ball club.
Let's go to Greg Thompson.
Association, welcome you to this opening session of the state girl AA high school basketball tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activity Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you enjoy the game and support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. Tonight's game features the Spartans of Spearfish and the Lynx of Brandon Valley. Let's meet the cheerleaders for the Lynx. Mackenzie Johnson, Addison Linke, Isla Mel, Bailey Mosley Shipper, Allison Newstead, Anna Shoey, Alyssa Tetsky, and Caitlin Warner. Their supervisors, Diane Terpstra and Hannah Gunther.
Time. It represents the past, the present, and the future, all at the same time. When you hear that it's state tournament time, what do you think about? Do you think about moments in the past? Maybe you think about one of the previous state championship teams. Or maybe it was the time your team came up just short and you can't shake it from your memory. When you hear it's state tournament time, do you think about the present? Do you think about the Spearfish Spartans? Or do you think about the Brandon Valley Lynx? Or maybe when you hear it's state tournament time, your mind goes to the future. And time will tell who is left standing and celebrating with this trophy and leaving with these nets. Time can represent many things, but this moment right here, this is your time.
And now let's meet the starters for tonight's game in alternating fashion. For the Spartans at guard, a 5'5 senior number one, Sophie Guthmiller. For the Lynx at guard, a 5'7 sophomore number two, Ava Kellenberger. for the Spartans at guard, a 5'6", junior number 10, Josie Dana. For the Lynx at guard, a 5'6", senior number 3, Kennedy Deckers. For the Spartans at forward, a 5'8", senior number 20, Addie Reiner. For the Lynx at forward, a 6'1", junior number 5, Madison Giever. For the Spartans at guard, a 5'7", sophomore number 23, Kate Scharf. For the Lynx at forward, a 5'9", senior number 24, Paisley Hoff. For the Spartans at center, a 6', senior number 30, Mariah Bowman. And for the Lynx at guard, a 5'7", sophomore, number 32, Olivia Padgett. The Spartans are led by Dakota Johnson, assistant coaches Jamie Bentley, Jamie Center, and Remy Winches. The Lynx are led by Mike Zurr, assistant coaches Jeff Lochner, Kenny Paula, Maggie Dady, and Emma Tavere. Your officials for this game, Roy Schwartzer, Jason Reisdorfer, and Kevin Talley.
5-5 against Brandon Valley. These two teams didn't meet during the regular season. Brandon Valley won 49-37. Before we go further, I want to correct myself. 2014 was the last time Spearfish was at the state tournament. They were also here in 2013 as well. So it's been 10 years since Spearfish girls have been at a state tournament. And there's a drive, a shot by Guffner, no good. Rebound by Giever.
You see Brandon Valley opening up in a little zone defense, almost looked like a extending out with Kellenberger in a little 1-2-2. Be interesting to see if they stick with that for a lot of tonight or rotating back and forth between man and zone.
Handling the ball is Padgett, their top scorer at 14 points per game. Runs into trouble, has to give it up to Kellenberger. Pass to the corner. Padgett open. No. Giever rebound. Stick back. Yes, and a foul.
And Giever's going to bring that presence inside.
Guffner with the foul.
Pins her defender underneath the rim with the and one. See if she can convert.
On the year, 65% at the free throw line. That one off the mark. And the rebound comes down to Bowman. Three sets of sisters on the Spartans. One set of sisters for Brandon Valley. In their lineup. Oh, errant pass, and it's out of bounds. And it will go to Brandon Valley.
In Brandon Valley there again, dropping back in the zone. Just appears to be a 2-3 alignment, but they extend out on the ball handlers.
Padgett with the drive, no, and the rebound swatted away, but there's a foul, and that will go against Brandon Valley. Key for Spearfish tonight, you gotta box out. Kellenberger, that's her first. Pressure applied. Scarf, the Scharf gets the inbounds pass. Dana, their main scorer, bounce pass, dangerous, picked up there by Guffmiller. Three on the way, no good, but there's the weak side rebound by Scharf.
Yeah, it can be challenging when you're extending out or dropping back into a zone to be able to rebound out of it, be able to find a body, and there's a nice drive and teardrop for the two.
Josie Dana averages 10.5 points per game, 5'8 junior.
And Padgett Grandin Valley is going to look to put her in a lot of ball screen situations, try to be a scorer and creator.
Padgett open on the perimeter, but here's Deckert, no good on the three. Kellenberger had it, lost it, picked up by Spearfish and Bowman. Guthmiller lost it, got it back, throws it up, no good, and the rebound to Padgett. Padgett also averages almost 3.5 rebounds a game.
A little faster pace than what we saw here in the first game tonight.
Yeah.
Both teams willing to get up and down the floor. Now it looks like Coach wants them to slow it up.
Dakota Johnson leading Spearfish. Mike Zur leading Brandon Valley. Wide open, pass underneath. Giever swatted it away. Into the hands of Hoff. Travel. Turnover. Links. Couple of subs in. Tiersen Grubb, number 21. Kochutin in. Maya Kochutin, 32. She averages 10.5 points per game.
Yeah, and Deckard had a nice early look there. There she decided to pass it up. And sometimes when you second guess yourself like that, you almost put yourself even in a little bit more trouble than what you started off with. You want her to stay confident. Anytime she gets her feet set as a coach, you want that one flying.
Dana connects on a three. 5-2 Spearfish. Dana matched up against Padgett. That's a good individual matchup there.
Yeah, and Dana, she has nice length to her. Little bit of size there. They switched the ball screen action.
Ball's loose on the floor. Pile up for it, and we're going to have a jump ball. Timeout on the court, 4:27 left to go. First quarter, Spearfish up 5-2. This is Class AA girls basketball in SDPB 3.
You live life on the move. While you determine what direction that may be, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with values. Go with friends. Go with support. Go with convenience.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our livestock, our pigs, is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Welcome back to the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls. Along with Nate Keating, Steve Toome here. Been a fast start to this one. Not necessarily on the scoreboard, but the players flying all over the court, Nate.
You love to see the effort. Bodies flying. There we had about a four-body pileup there on the loose ball. And you can tell the stakes that they all feel here tonight.
Yeah, especially for Spearfish. They haven't been here in 10 years. There's a drive and a shot up, and it's good. Checking in, Amanda Leese, number 14, a 5'7 junior.
Yeah, Amanda, first year at Brandon Valley. She was actually a good player at Canton High School prior to this season, and has provided a nice spark for Brandon Valley this year off the bench.
Block from behind into the hands of Padgett. Has trouble handling it. Spearfish back defensively. Lisa drive, a shot, yes. She averages 3.5 points, 2 rebounds a game, but man, she's made an impact, a big impact right away for Brandon Valley.
Yeah, wasting no time. Attacking both times, right hand, strong hand.
Shot, might have been partially blocked. Lisa ends up with the loose ball. Now Padgett on the move, long pass, up ahead. Collecting the ball was Gracie Salter. Now there's Leese, no on the three. Rebound out of bounds to Spearfish. Both teams will go to their bench pretty frequently. They'll bring two, three players, maybe more off the bench. Duff Miller in, Scharf out for the Spartans.
Yeah, slightly different than what we saw in the first game tonight that really relied on six, maybe seven. These two teams will go a little bit deeper into their bench than what we saw from Mitchell and Harrisburg.
And with the style both teams can play, Spearfish a little more known for this. They want those fresh legs out there as Duff Miller mishandles it off their foot out of bounds.
And there you can see the zone. They're really extending that pressure out. I mean, oftentimes you're going to see two different, sometimes when you're in a 2-3, you're going to try to pack things in as much as possible and try to force teams to beat you from the outside. And then other times you're going to try to make them uncomfortable and extend them out on the floor.
That one will roll in for Giever. 6'2 junior, 7.5 points. He also has a bunch of blocks, 12 on the season.
Giever with a nice jump hook there.
And traveling the call, making the move there was Kochutin. She made her move from the corner, but shuffled the feet first.
Yeah, it's going to be really key for Spearfish, especially with Brandon Valley extending out. There's going to be some driving lanes into the zone. There's going to be some passing lanes into the zone. So they need to find those sweet spots, find those areas. And oftentimes, no, it's not going to be that initial person that shoots. But you got to be able to get to that space and that spot and then see where your teammates are at.
Reese Condon handles the ball now, number 20, sophomore guard, 5'6". 12 on the shot clock. Giever posting up. Travel. Turnover. And you know, we mentioned this earlier, you know, with some of the players have those bright colored shoes like Giever has. You know, that could maybe hurt you because it's easier to spot when they shuffle. When they shuffle your feet.
Maria there did a great job of walling up, putting her chest on Giever, staying down, and yeah, you're right. They caught the pink shoes.
Oh, look out into the stands on the errant pass.
Get your hands ready there, Steve. You could have snatched that one.
Well, that was beyond my reach. Got to have your hands up, your eyes up. Especially courtside where we're at here at the Pentagon. We got a great view. We hope you're enjoying the pictures here from the Pentagon. On SDPB 3, under 2 minutes to go. Brandon Valley up, there's Salter, missed. Might have been partially blocked, but there's a pass that's knocked away and intercepted by Decker.
Decker with the activity, end up, she was trying to find Paisley Hoff, running back down the floor and end up giving it right back.
Teams trade turnovers. It goes to Spearfish. Double team, and the ball's loose on the floor again. Hustling, and who touched it last? Spearfish. It goes to Brandon Valley.
It's gonna be tough with Brandon Valley sitting in a little 1-2-2, 1-2-1-1 to just try to dribble through that. You got to be able to beat that with the pass, and then hopefully get a numbers advantage. And force them to pay on the other end.
In the corner, Salter with the ball. Condon, open shooter is Decker, yes.
It's a great action. The corner pin down screen for the shooter. Decker comes out, drills it.
Foul on Brandon Valley, that's gonna be on Hoff. And that is her first, team's second. Guth Miller out, Scharf back in for Spearfish. Spearfish was up 5-2 at one point. 9-0 run here by Brandon Valley.
See the defensive intensity. Reese Condon's coming in and really putting some pressure on the ball handlers. And as you can see here early, Spearfish having to operate their offense way outside of an operating area right now.
And there
Condon again.
You called it. Condon gets her hand on the ball, but Spearfish gets it right back. And a foul on Brandon Valley.
Spearfish right now early on, not even through one, and have five turnovers right now on the game. And something we saw earlier, and the value in the basketball, it's so key all the time, but when you get to positions like this in the game, where oftentimes they're gonna be 1-2 possession ball games, it's just so important that you take care of it.
Nice setup for the three-pointer on the inbounds play. Long rebound. Here's Deckard on the move. Three on one. Lost the handle. Got it back. Scores.
Impressive read there by Deckard. Defender decided to go with Padgett. Run to the floor.
I thought for a moment she may have lost the handle. And it's going to be off of Condon out of bounds. And then Deckard just managed to collect herself and put it up and in.
Condon just been a pest right now defensively. Just active hands and deflections. It's a coach's dream.
Mm-hmm. Got to have that hustle on defense.
And there she is again.
In the middle of the action, bounce pass ahead. Padgett got it. Nifty play. That's her first points of the night. And don't look now, but the Lynx are up by 10, and there's a foul. That'll be on Condon in the backcourt, and that's her first, team's fourth.
The pressure that the Lynx are providing right now on Spearfish is really paying dividends and really forcing Spearfish out of a comfort zone here as the clock winds down.
You're going to have to fire a three, and it's going to be off the mark, and that's how the first quarter will end. Brandon Valley impressive, up 15-5 on Spearfish. Back with the second quarter after this one-minute break on SDPB3.
You've worked hard to build your business, your reputation, your success. Your financial partner should be committed to digging in, to drive your vision forward. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other. Lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
Brandon Valley out to a great start, 15-5, a 13-0 run there for Brandon Valley to close out that quarter. Spearfish was up 5-2, but it's been all Lynx since.
Yeah, forced turnovers, and really not many unforced ones right now from Spearfish. Brandon Valley is just being super active right now defensively and causing fits for Spearfish.
Eight turnovers against the Spartans, just three for Brandon Valley. Shooting wise, 22% for Spearfish, 54% for Brandon Valley after that first period of play. Dana has all 5 points for Spearfish. And getting in trouble there was Scharf outside, a big three.
And that's what you like to see though. Scharf cutting right to the middle of that zone, catching it. It took a while to find somebody, but she was able to do that. And goes back on the other end and gets set for the charge.
Offensive foul. And that will be on Gracie Salter. That's her first. Her team fouls reset at the end of each period. No pressure in the backcourt. They'll find Guthmiller, who's back into the game.
Yeah, and in the half court here, they really need it. There, we get another flash, high-low look. Beautiful.
Nice.
And that's what you really need to understand, pass versus dribble against the zone. And so far here in the second quarter, they're doing a great job of finding the middle of it.
Mariah Bowman got that, and it's tapped away. It's loose on the floor, and a foul is going to be on Salter. And quickly, she picks up two fouls, and that's going to get Lease up to the scorer's table for Brandon Valley. Just underway, second quarter, and Spearfish has gotten five quick, desperately needed points.
Yeah, their zone attack here in the second quarter has been a lot more efficient than the first. Clearly, Coach Johnson, it was an emphasis at the quarter break.
Three-pointer up and no good, and the rebound to Kellenberger. And she is fouled from behind by Addie Reiners, and that is her first foul. We have a sub in for Spearfish coming in. Kochutin and Guthmiller out. And there's the long three put up and in by Kellenberger, a 31% shooter from beyond the arc.
Pageant, nice vision there. Finds Kellenberger for the wide open three.
Spearfish down by eight, facing that zone. High post, now to the outside. Kochutin, shot, no. Rebound, foul. It's gonna be on Brandon Valley.
Spearfish just much more comfortable here in the second quarter. They're flashing different people to the middle of the zone. Their scarf gets it immediately, looks opposite. You can tell that they prepared for this. Just it took them a minute to get comfortable and under control against it in the first quarter.
Decker got that last foul, and then Lease travels after getting the rebound. And a turnover for Brandon Valley.
Yeah, Coach Zier is having a little discussion there on the sideline, wondering where that one is at.
But here's an interception by Deckard. She'll get it back. Shot blocked away, but a foul. Foul will be on Reiners, her second.
She's one of those players that just constantly in attack mode. If she gets any type of space separation, whether it's we talked about it to start our broadcast here, she's capable of scoring it from all three levels, at the rim, mid-range, from three, and she's just relentless when that ball's in her hands.
Guthmiller in, and two fouls. Reiners has to go to the Spearfish bench. 6:05 left until halftime. Brandon Valley has doubled up Spearfish 20-10. Guthmiller, and that one saved by Scharf. And Brandon Valley just aggressive on defense, and I think they're gonna get a jump ball. Nope, they're gonna get a foul.
Yeah, the activity level right now of the Lynx, they're extending out, they're flying around. As Spearfish, you're almost getting two separate possessions. You need to be able to flow and beat their press and then operate when you get in the half court. And in a perfect world, you want to make teams that are pressing be able to play, be able to pay and create some advantages right away. But right now, Brandon Valley's doing a great job of sprinting back and still setting their half-court defense.
I think Bowman got cut, he's bleeding. She's got to come out of the game for Spearfish. They get the fresh shot clock to work with after that last foul on Padgett, her first. Here's a three on the way, off the mark. And we're gonna have Giever with the rebound and Dana with the foul, her first.
And Scarf, she can do that. 36 made threes, leads them, made threes on the year, and she's one. When that ball hits the middle of the zone, you want to find her. So they're gonna live with those.
Padgett on the move, drives to the outside. Kellenberger spins, yes, 5 points for her on the night.
A tough finish there with the offhand by Kellenberger.
And we're gonna have a bumping foul. And that may be the 15th foul on Brandon Valley, and it will be. So two free throws coming up the rest of the way in this quarter.
Yeah, when you're being as aggressive as they are right now defensively, sometimes as a coach and as a staff, you're gonna have to live with that a little bit. You got to take the good and the bad. Certainly, you want to try to show those hands as much as you can.
Kochutin gets the free throw. That was the second foul on Padgett, by the way. She'll have to check out. But her team is up by 11 at the moment. That one's good. Kochutin, 86% on the year.
Yeah, it will be interesting to see if Coach Zier just leaves Pageant on the bench with two for the rest of the half, or he trusts her to give some minutes playing with two.
Three on the way, no good. And here's Spearfish with the rebound, and they're on the move. Sharp getting in trouble, and we are going to have a foul, and it's going to be on Brandon Valley. Timeout on the court, 4:48 left to go. Second quarter, Brandon Valley up by 10. Back in a moment on SDPB 3.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it, while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
.22-12, Brandon Valley on top of Spearfish, along with Nate Kading, Steve Toom here. Class AA girls basketball from the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Our last game of the day, O'Gorman, Harrisburg, Sioux Falls, Jefferson, winners earlier today. They're into the semifinals. One of these two teams will join them.
Yeah, balanced offensive effort right now for the Lynx. Kellenberger with five, Deckard five, Beaver four, Lees four, Pageant four. Offense right now for Spearfish isn't, it hasn't been as easy to come by.
Both free throws are missed by Scharf, a 36% free throw shooter on the year. Deckert with the ball, gets it back, fires the three off the mark. And it's in the hands of Lees.
That's a great basketball play by Deckert there, sliding so the ball could see her.
And the ball's loose on the floor, and who's got it? Spearfish gets the steal.
Numbers advantage here.
Three on two, and Kochutin misses the layup. Tipped away at half court, and Lees ends up with it. Contact, foul. And that's going to be on Bowman, and that's her first.
Well, helter-skelter action there for a set.
And two subs in for Spearfish, Scharf and Bowman to the bench. Maddie Donovan, first time seeing her.
Yeah, we'll be key here for the Lynx with Pageant on the bench to see where their offense. Oh, and there's a great screen the screener action, and Hoff slips right back to the basketball. Two defenders go with one.
Hoff, that's her first points. And Brandon Valley in control, 24-12. There's Condon making a play out on the perimeter, forcing the action. The three on the way, rattles and falls for Kochutin. Wow, shooter's touch there.
Yeah, they're gonna need her to provide some offense here.
She does average 10.5 points per game. She's got five at the moment. The lob down low, tapped away by Spearfish. Dana on the run. Cut off from the rim. Kochutin a long three. No. Rebound. Lynx. Now they want to run. Deckard will pick up her dribble.
Yeah, and Coach Zier's got Pageant over there sitting at the scorer's table, wants her to come in, finish the half. She's just such a huge key for them offensively.
Jump ball. Possession arrow. Lynx. Here comes Pageant, Giever in, Condon, and Hoff out for for the Lynx. 14 on the shot clock.
You've created this 9-point advantage so far. There's screen down, right, nice. Garrett Giever again with that left shoulder jump hook for the second time tonight.
And use the window.
Yeah, she's got soft hands, soft feet down there. Impressive player inside.
Pass to the corner, nothing there for Spearfish. Echo shooting in a bunch of trouble, floats it up, and that will not fall. Giever gets the rebounds. Outlet Paget. Met at half court, gets around to the defender. Deckard fakes the three. Paget so quick with her feet, scores.
Constantly in attack mode.
13 is the advantage for Brandon Valley. Spearfish needs some points, needs to cut into this deficit in the final 2 minutes. Throws to the outside, Guff Miller has it tapped away, but Lise gets the foul. And that'll be her first.
Brandon Valley just really tries to jump out in passing lanes a lot. And oftentimes as an offensive player, it's a bit awkward because they take away normal basketball angles and basketball plays. And that's where you got to have a good sense, even mixing in pass fakes and ball fakes and get that defender to jump out. Then you got to attack the gap and play your numbers advantage from there.
One of two at the line, Guff Miller. She'll check out in favor of Scharf. And with a minute 54 left, Spearfish has some work to do.
Yeah, you feel like this last 2 minutes is an important part of things here. We'll see how things finish up.
Lisa three, too strong. Scharf pulls it away from Kellenberger. Dana with the ball. Going to Donovan.
It's a zone defense's best friend when the ball just sticks and stalls. You got it. Oh, great hustle there.
Donovan makes the play. Kochutin on the move, and her pass was slapped out of bounds. Or was it a shot? Don't know.
I think she was trying to find her teammate that was sprinting down on the right side. Great hustle there. Great hustle by Donovan getting on the deck.
Scharf, the great fake, and collects the two.
Nice shot fake, one dribble pull up by Scharf. And you need to react to her shooting ability. Great job of reading the defender.
Under a minute to go.
See if they can get a stop and a score, cut this thing to single digits.
Paget pull up Jay, short of the mark. Giever stepped out of bounds. That'll give the ball to the Spartans.
Yeah, Brandon Valley will. They will get another possession back there. 45 on the game clock, 35 on the shot clock.
Condon in, Paget out for Brandon Valley.
Us analytics people, Steve, we call this the 2-for-1. You know, Brandon yep. Valley's trying to get it. Oh, Condon.
Again,
the
she makes it.
Defensive pass.
And she gets the layup. What a difference maker she has been defensively for Brandon Valley. Shot clock off. The Lynx up by a dozen. Scharf on the move. No. Rebound. Release. Plenty of time for Brandon Valley to set up for one. Condon looks things over. 10 seconds. Lease gets the ball. Intercepted by Scharf at half court. Won't matter that she traveled. 30-18. That's where we stand at the intermission as it is Brandon Valley on top of Spearfish. We'll step aside for a couple of moments, come back and have more from the girls' AA basketball tournament right here on SDPB3.
We hope you're a fan of stories about heroes, because we'd like you to meet a few of ours. These folks keep our communities moving forward. They're dedicated to being here for you, navigating change, keeping you secure, and offering a helping hand to those who need it. Heroes come from many walks. Ours are here to walk with you. Go with trust. Go with people. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
We're all going somewhere, going higher, faster, farther, going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care, with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring, keep making memories, keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
First Dakota is here for the shared community experiences, the competition, long-standing rivalries, the players and coaches, seeing friends again, and cheering on our favorite teams. It's what makes life great here, and First Dakota is here for it.
We're at halftime here, Brandon Valley on top of Spearfish, 30-18. Let's go to Greg Thompson, our public address announcer.
We'd like you to direct your attention to the area in front of the band, the tournament band that has been playing for today's sessions of the state basketball tournament is from Bridgewater Emory High School under the direction of Tim Zor. In appreciation for the fine music the band has been providing during the games, Randy Soma of the South Dakota High School Activities Association is now presenting to Tim, director of the Bridgewater Emory Pep Band, a plaque to commemorate the day.
Nice job, Bridgewater Emory Ethan, their band performing here at the AA Girls Basketball Tournament. Halftime, Brandon Valley on top of Spearfish, 30-18. We'll be back with more. We'll have highlights and stats after this break right here on SDPB3.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Oh my goodness.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour, you know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal. All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actagra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do. And that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
And welcome back to the Pentagon here in Sioux Falls. Heritage Court is the site for this year's state girls AA basketball tournament. Along with Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toom. At the break here, it is Brandon Valley ahead of Spearfish, 30-18. And Nate, well, your just impressions from that first half of play.
Yeah, Brandon Valley came out right. You look at that first quarter and they created that 10-point advantage right away. And the second quarter, Spearfish was a lot more comfortable attacking that zone defense. But really, it was how they started the game. And you look at their offensive balance right now. They've had, we got 2, 4, 6, 7 people that have scored. Nobody with more than 6 points in relation to Spearfish that just hasn't quite gotten that balance offensively and just haven't been as efficient. They've gotten the shots. Both teams are turning it over more than their coaches would like with 10 and 11. I can guarantee that. But right now the Lynx are just capitalizing on their opportunities better than Spearfish is.
Brandon Valley dominating on the glass at 17-9, and they've hit twice as many field goals as Spearfish. They're just 27%. 6 of 22. Let's check out some of these highlights from the first half. As you see, Josie Dana knocking down the three-pointer. She had all 5 of the points, and there's Amanda Lee. She really provided a spark, as this young lady did. Madison Giever in the paint with her play. Outside, left-handed shot, up and good. There's Deckard on the move. She lost it, got it back, throws it up and in.
Yeah, they've just done a great job of finishing when they've got the ball in zone one around the rim. And you know, we just saw there are only 2 3-point makes, but you can see some of these tougher finishes converting at a high level right now.
That pass was tipped out of bounds. And then they go inside. That was a nice inbounds play. It went to Paisley Hoff. And the shot from the outside from Spearfish falls. That's Kochutin. And then Condon, boy, what a difference maker she was defensively in that first half. That was her only points, but boy, she was great with 3 steals in that first half and really applying the pressure defensively for Brandon Valley.
Played 5 minutes, had about 10 plus deflections and really set the tone. And Kellenberger does it as well. Whoever's kind of in the top of that zone, the top of that press, can really set the tone and force Spearfish to play outside of their comfort zone and in an operating area.
Well, Spearfish is going to have to find something to overcome this 12-point deficit. But it has happened in the almost in the three previous games. That game was close late between Mitchell and Harrisburg before Harrisburg pulled away in the final moments to win. But our games in the afternoon saw big deficits, double-digit deficits that were overcome nearly. Went down to the last minute. Well, Gorman and Stevens went overtime, as a matter of fact.
And boiling it it down as simple as he can. The two field goal percentage difference in order for Spearfish to get back in the game, they need to guard at a higher level. Can't allow the Lynx another 56% from the floor, and they need to be more efficient and convert at a higher clip offensively.
Dana in the paint weaves her way through traffic and scores right away. That gives her 10.
That was a great set play there by Coach Johnson. Overloaded one side, flash from behind, ripped right to the rim.
Just what the Spartans needed to start the second half. They're still down by 10. Now the Spartans need to get some stops defensively. Easier said than done as Deckert's on the move. Hoff, three, yes.
Drive and kick, Paisley Hoff, feet set, knocks it down, and here's
jump ball. Possession arrow will go to Brandon Valley.
Brandon Valley right now, it seems like they got about six or seven defenders out on the court with their activity. Impressive thus far tonight.
Padgett on the move, gives way to Deckard. Giever had it, lost it, now tied up, and I think we're gonna have a jump ball. Yes, we will, and that'll give the ball back to Spearfish.
And Giever's got a clear size advantage inside, and you can tell that possession as the ball pretty much stayed on the left side that they're really trying to get it into her, get her touches, and then play out of it.
Brandon Valley up by 13. Dana, no, had a wide open look. Spearfish fighting for it, but Deckert comes away with it.
And if you're able to get the ball clean like Spearfish was out of the trap, because Brandon Valley, they'll put two defenders on the ball early on in half-court possession. So do you make one, two clean passes, you can end up with high-quality looks.
There's a steal on the block pass. On the run out, scoring the layup is Bowman. That gives her four. Nice defensive play and puts the lead to 11.
Yeah, Bowman, a good looking athlete. There she shows some ball handling ability in the full court.
A lot of multi-sport athletes out here for Spearfish. Here's a steal and Dana on the run, but missed it. Guthmiller there to put it in. And we have a timeout on the court as there's a player injured, and that's Giever for Brandon Valley. Mentioned Bowman, she is going to play volleyball at School of Mines in Rapid City next year.
I can see it, Steve. We got ourselves maybe a little outside hitter, a little middle maybe. I don't know. We're sports connoisseurs, Steve. We know everything. Golf, volleyball, basketball, you name it.
I know a little about volleyball. I rely on the people that know more about it to fill me in on the gaps. But I do love calling volleyball, and unfortunately I missed this year's tournament because I was sick. Brian Oakland filled in for me as we got a pushing foul. And again, thank you to Brian Oakland for filling in for me while I was recuperating. And that foul will be on Maddie Donovan. As her first. Down low, spin, Hoff, no. Fighting for the rebound, Brandon Valley gets it back. Padgett, yes.
Good extra effort play by Padgett. Comes up with the loose ball. When you provide that effort, fortuitous bounces come your way.
Here's a three on the way. No, Coach Hooten missed it, but Dana with the rebound has to retreat to the outside. Coach Hooten gets it back, misfires again, and there is Salter getting the rebound. Padgett on the move, fighting off Donovan, who slows her down. Padgett drives, kicks to the outside, wide open three, no. Ball tapped out of bounds. Who's that's going to? Lovers have to confer. And I think that will be Brandon Valley ball as the teams take a break here. Hey, a lot to tell you about this program we've been working on that features a lot of stories about basketball from this year. It's called Tales from the Hardwood. Because, you know, high school basketball is such a huge part of what represents our communities and towns all over South Dakota. Now, on Saturday, March 9th, you can join SDPB as we take you on a journey into some of the stories, the players, and the teams that surround our basketball courts here in the Mount Rushmore State. We'll have stories on a town honoring a longtime coach, a student manager whose skills extend to a much different kind of court. Also, we'll meet a player turned coach and see how one student athlete has dealt with the unique disability. All this and more on this year's editions of Tales from the Hardwood. That'll be after the championship game on SDPB1 on Saturday, March the 9th. And it is a great job. Nate Weck and the gang put that together. And again, fantastic job. So many stories, and we get to meet so many interesting people. Tales from the Gridiron for the football season, Tales from the Hardwood for basketball season. Just some amazing stories about the communities. And, you know, I grew up in this state. Basketball is such a huge, huge part of so many communities.
Yeah, the quality coaches and the quality people that are involved with high school hoops around this area. And you know, people should feel lucky. It's not that way necessarily everybody or everywhere, but certainly around here, it's fun to be a part of and fun to watch.
Quickly inside, Salter scores her first points of the night on a nice inbounds play out of the timeout.
The screener has been the beneficiary twice on a couple easy finishes underneath out of bounds for Brandon Valley.
Dana up top puts a shot up, no. Rebound fought for, Lease comes away with it. Padgett on the move.
Yeah, and here's where they want to attack. They want to get that ball popping.
It's really danger time for Spearfish because they're down by 13. They can't afford to fall much farther back. They need to get some stops. And that ball is going to be tipped out of bounds by Dana. It'll stay with Brandon Valley, 16 on the shot clock.
Yeah, look for Pageant to get the ball in her hands. Early high ball screen here.
Salter sets the screen and we'll have a bump foul. And that will be, I think, on Bowman. And it is her second.
And Donovan's working, trying to be evasive around those screens. Pageant's just a player that you gotta constantly be on alert. You can't take any seconds to relax, no breaths in between.
So quick, look out. Players hitting the deck left and right. Padgett got tripped up on her way to the bucket.
Yeah, and Donovan was playing the high side of that screen there, trying to take away Padgett's strong hand. She's one of those players, though. She's almost more effective. Loves that hesitation, attack left. Certainly can go both directions. Such a skilled, athletic player.
Padgett's just a sophomore. That's just scary.
Scary for the rest of AA here for the next couple of years.
Lease misfires on the three, but there's Salter almost with the stick back. Finally, Bowman gets the rebound. And there is a bump, and that's going to be on Condon, and that'll be her second. Boy, a whole lot of contact going on.
Yeah, you talk about sophomores, right? Right now, Condon sophomore, Pageant sophomore, Salter sophomore. Brandon Valley with some youth out on the court.
Yep, Kellenberger is a sophomore as well. Lisa junior. Boy, this team's going to be very, very tough. They've got a couple of seniors in Hoff and Deckert, but this team is going to be a team to contend with over the next couple of years here in the AA ranks. Say, well, I've got a moment. You know, SDPB connects South Dakotans throughout our statewide network, and we're able to bring you the girls' basketball coverage because of support from viewers like you. Become a member now, and your gift will be matched. Donate online, sdpb.org. You can also call 1-800-777-0789. There you look at the team stats at the moment. Brandon Valley, better than 50% from the floor. Spearfish at 9 of 29, that's 31%. Turnovers, 14 for Brandon Valley, 11 from Spearfish. But Brandon Valley, look at the rebounding edge, more than 2-1.
Yeah, you just feel like right now, in order for Spearfish to close this gap, that they're
they're going to need some outside shots to go down. You know, they relied a lot on the three-point shot coming in. I've only hit three of them so far yet today. They need to be able to get that ball middle of the zone, attack it, and then find open shooters from there.
3.5 minutes left to go in this third quarter. Spearfish in trouble, and I think she might have stepped out of bounds.
They just, Brandon Valley, they get you to be on spots on the court that you don't want to be in. Mm-hmm. Pressed up tight against the sideline, pressed up right across the half line when you come across. You gotta try to do whatever you can to stay out of those positions with the basketball.
Lease, got it. A little off balance, but Deckert made the good pass. Spearfish down by 15. Still got time. They need to find something. There's a backdoor cutter, but the ball's taken away by Lease. Outlet Deckert.
Trying to turn defense to offense here. Lease cutting.
And she traveled. Turnover, Brandon Valley.
Yeah, the pace that Brandon Valley is playing with tonight is impressive. Certainly they're creating turnovers, but they're not taking any time once they get those. They're looking to advance the ball up with the pass as much as they can and play fast.
Into the paint, Bowman maneuvers and scores. Bowman with six.
Yeah, Bowman, impressive finish over Giever. And that's been a factor. You got a rim protector like Giever with her size back there. It makes you feel, and there's Lease picking up an offensive foul. It makes you feel better as defenders out on the perimeter that you're able to take some more chances and force that ball into your big six-footer inside.
Well, here's an opportunity from Spearfish. The offensive foul gives the ball back to him. Second team foul on Brandon Valley. Spearfish, three team fouls in this quarter. Spearfish has the opportunity to cut into that lead some more. Kuchutin with the ball. Oh, does she lose it? There's a pileup, still loose, and Dana gets it. But a timeout was called by Spearfish to maintain possession. Dakota Johnson standing right there. The ball stays with the Spartans, down still by 13 points.
Kuchutin there trying to make something happen off the dribble. With Brandon Valley's activity, not only with their hands, but they also have some good guard quickness out there. And as we talked about Giever and inside, they got a very, very nice mixture defensively that's hard to play against, really. And we can see that from the percentages that we've seen and the spots that they've forced Spearfish to go on the court here tonight.
Madison Giever, her dad, Matt, is a Hall of Famer at Mount Marty for basketball. He's 6'9". So must be a tall, tall family there.
Yeah, get used to the name. She's got a younger sister who's a freshman on the team that's also a good basketball player. Not quite. Oh, there's a nice high post look and finish.
Two-pointer. I think that was Guthmiller who got that. Brandon Valley with the ball. Deckert goes to Salter. And the holding foul, two free throws coming up.
Little big-to-big pass. They flash Salter to the high post. She goes right inside to Giever. Giever maybe got away with shuffling those feet a little bit, potentially.
Check, Kuchutin got that last bucket. Giever, two free throws coming up. It's the first. Bowman out. And checking in is Reiners. Reiners has been on the bench for a long time. Free throw no good. Good shooting with the ball. Passes over to Guthmiller. She lost the handle. And we're probably going to have a jump ball, and we will. Possession arrow, Brandon Valley.
Yeah, when you're trying to cut in this 12-point deficit, every possession just becomes very, very, very important. You got to utilize those. You want to make sure that you're trying to get shots up every single time. The activity level of Brandon is something. It's created 14, 15 turnovers already.
Padgett will get some free throws. That foul is going to be on Scharf, and that is her first.
And really, as Coach Zerr, I mean, you love to see their shooting percentage, their field goal percentage at 55%. They've attacked inside out. Even then, they can do a little bit better job. Right now, they have 16 turnovers themselves. This game could be even a larger discrepancy than what we currently have, Steve. They value the ball at a bit higher level.
Offensive rebound for Brandon Valley. There's another one for him as don't know how a travel wasn't called there. Decker maneuvers into the paint, lost the handle, and it's into the hands of Dana. Guth Miller passes, but out of bounds, intended for Reiners. Five team fouls on Spearfish, two on Brandon Valley.
I think you can see there, Brandon Valley's just made it so tough on Spearfish right now on the half court that when they do get any ounce of daylight, they're maybe pressing and pushing a little bit.
Down low, Deckard's open and scores, number seven.
A great screen at the high post by Giever there and a hard, aggressive cut.
Dana a little too strong, went off the back iron. Coach Uten will be fouled. Two free throws coming up for Spearfish. And Giever gets the foul, her first. Shooting at the line, 2 of 2 on the night, 86% on the year. Shooter's touch. Dana yeah. out and Donovan in for Spearfish.
Feel like every one of these at the foul line that you get, they need right now. Want to try to close this down into single digits as soon as they can to give themselves a chance to draw it into a 2-3 possession game.
Shot clock is off. Salter with the ball. Down low, tapped away by Donovan out of bounds. He was trying to guard the much larger Giever. And a great play by Donovan to tap that one away.
A quick little water bug all over the place.
Padgett triggers, 3.2 seconds left. Down low, Salter scores. What an empty play. Towel in the third period of play. Brandon Valley on top of Spearfish. 45-30. Back with the final stanza in 1 minute on SDPB3.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Brandon Valley on top of Spearfish, along with Nate Kading. Steve Toon here, and the balance tonight for Brandon Valley, Nate, has just been impressive with their scoring.
Yeah, sharing the basketball. A lot's kind of started from the head of the snake with Padgett starting that early offense, but from there, they're playing off each other, moving without the basketball, looking inside to Giever. Deckard, obviously, knocked down open three. Kellenberger, same thing. Paisley Hoff.
Been impressive, very impressive. Bowman pass down low off the fingertips of Dana out of bounds. Turnover Spearfish.
you really look at just both sides of the basketball right now. They've been efficient offensively. They've been stingy defensively. It's a good all-around floor game by the Lynx.
Lob ahead, Padgett lost it. Hose gets it, Spearfish. Dana drives, but too strong. Up tall, Salter with it, pulls it down. That's a mistake, jump ball.
Just the one thing that they're gonna have to clean up if they're fortunate enough to finish this game moving into the semifinals is just valuing the basketball, taking care of the basketball. There they go over the top to Padgett.
Yes, and the foul. 11 for Padgett. First player for Brandon Valley in double figures.
The good body control by Padgett there. He's able to take the blow, take the contact, finish right through it.
Missed the free throw. Dana got the foul. That's her third. Again, body's hitting the deck. Alternating possession to Spearfish. Brandon Valley just token pressure. Point lead. Guthmiller, oh, almost a trick shot. Rebound to Spearfish. They'll throw it out to the perimeter. Dana, yes. She's got a dozen.
Dana with a nice teardrop in the friendly roll. And that's why you got to have a heightened sense of urgency right now. Every possession's vital on both sides of the floor.
Yeah, Spearfish needs some stops, and then they need to connect on the other end. Tough to stop that lady, but there is Giever, missed it. Boy, two close opportunities there for Brandon Valley.
Yeah, oftentimes when you're able to draw that help defender, it's tough to get that first rebound, and there's Sharp with the corner three.
Her first tray of the night. Gives her seven.
See if that can get the Spearfish team rolling.
Padgett on the handoff from Lease. Double high screen there. Lease drives, hooks it up, nope, but Giever gets it, tapped away out of bounds by Kochutin. It'll stay with the Lynx with 6:09 left. Buff Miller out, Donovan in.
Being able to finish that first possession, first shot for Spearfish. So important right now.
Giever, yes.
And for the fourth time tonight, they've hit the screener on underneath out of bounds. Clearly they saw something with Spearfish switching a lot of those screens. The switch defender gets caught on top. 8 points right there. Off underneath, out of bounds, right back to the screeners. Coach Zer's loving that.
Yeah, I think Coach Johnson and her staff are going to be seeing that play in their nightmares tonight. And that's opened up a big 14-point lead here for Brandon Valley as they are seeking a date with Harrisburg. As we look at the updated team stats, again, Brandon Valley dominating on the glass, 28-16. Turnovers relatively even. Three-pointers, a few are falling from Spearfish, but they're just 13 of 36 from the floor for 36%. Brandon Valley at 54% from the floor on 21 of 39 shooting. That's just good shot selection and good passing by Brandon Valley.
Yeah, their defensive effort right now, inactivity in their press, activity especially in their half-court zone, just been something that's given Spearfish a lot of fists. They just haven't been able to move the ball like they're probably used to. They haven't been able to get the basketball in the spots that they need to, and clean three-point looks have been hard to come by.
Points in the paint, 30-12, advantage Brandon Valley. Play resumes. Bowman gets the ball, double team. Donovan has to kick it outside to Dana. Bowman's gonna set up for a three, in and out. Salter pulls the ball away from Donovan.
Salter's done a nice job with backup minutes behind Giever, bringing a physical presence, chasing it on the glass.
They'll find Padgett. Blocked by Bowman. Dana on the move. Three on the way, in and out again. Spearfish gets the rebound.
Kachutin's had a few of them tonight that have been about halfway down and just can't get them to fall when you need.
Donovan was the intended recipient, but that was Hoff who steals it away. Padgett, nice backdoor pass to Deckard. Yes! Oh, what a nifty play for Brandon Valley.
Textbook basketball right there. Textbook basketball.
Kachutin, no. Try to get her own rebound. And we're going to have a jump ball. Possession arrow for Brandon Valley. Timeout on the court. Brandon Valley in control at 52-35. Back in a minute right here on SDPB3.
It's time to focus on you, a healthier you. It's time to get back to better health. Regular visits with a primary care provider at Sanford Health can lead to better overall health and wellness. It's time to get back to regular care. It's time for a healthier you and better health. It's time to see your doctor at Sanford Health.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Brandon Valley has built up a big lead, and they have kept Spearfish at arm's length pretty much all the second half. Nate Keating joins me, Steve Toome, here at courtside in the Pentagon. Girls AA basketball tournament, 4:35 left to go in the final period. And Brandon Valley, they have been in control, executing at a high level.
Yeah, both offensively and defensively, it's been fun to watch, frankly. They were ready to come into this game and provide their best effort, and they've done so here tonight.
Deckard on the move, kick it back outside. Padgett pulls up, short. Rebound, Spearfish. It's Adeline Bowman, number three in the game for Spearfish. And Guth Miller's shot is short, and Salter gets another rebound. And a foul on Spearfish.
Yeah, they force you to make multiple good basketball reads and in decisions and passes, and then they always have a 6'2" or 6' girl around the rim that's ready to protect. So they're difficult to score against. They're difficult to play against.
Liner's got that foul. I believe that's her third. Padgett, oh, dribbled it off her knee, but got it back.
Yeah, and Coach Zier wants them to be patient here. Just Kellenberger with a nice Euro step. Ends up getting to the foul line.
And that foul is on Dana. That's her fourth. Dana with a dozen on the night. She's had a good night, but Brandon Valley has just been so solid. Kellenberger makes the free throw, give her 6 points. Missed that one, and Bowman gets the rebound. Outlet to sister Adeline. There's Mariah. She'll get it back. Nice move in the paint. Too strong off the window. Salter. Outlets to Deckard. Deckard is going to be fouled. No. Nope. They're going to say it wouldn't have counted anyway. Foul on the floor.
Salter's provided them some great energy, great effort off the bench. Both protecting the rim and making sure that Spearfish is one and done anytime they get the ball on the rim.
Padgett triggers into Salter. Down low, Padgett with the left hand finishes. She's scary good.
Yeah, for a guard too. She's got good strength to her, you know, and she's not afraid of using that strength and playing through contact.
Two free throws coming up for Dana here as she just took it right at the defender. And that was Salter, that's her third personal. 20-point lead for Brandon Valley. Dana with 13 points on the night. Here comes Giever in to give Salter a break.
Yeah, not often do you see state tournament. It's been a very, very impressive effort that they just kept that distance the entire time. You know, even when Spearfish would string a bucket or two, Brandon Valley was answering. They haven't had it in single digits for quite some time, and they just always kept them at arm's length. And unless something crazy happens, gonna finish this one out tonight.
And the thing is, in every period, Brandon Valley has had at least different players score. Most of the time, they've had five or six people scoring every period as a good defensive play by Bowman gets the steal. Outlet Dana. Dana on the move, blocked by Kellenberger. And it's out of bounds to Spearfish. Yeah, Brandon Valley had four players score in the first. Six players in the second. Six players in the third score, and five different players have scored here in this final period. Tipped by Kellenberger, right to Decker. Outlet pass.
Yeah, it's a good problem to have your court, Coach Zero. You got quality bench and figuring out, rolling with the five that are playing the best at certain time and understanding what buttons to push, and he's certainly done so tonight.
Yeah, this has been a great team effort by Brandon Valley. Just everybody making contributions, even the players that aren't scoring a whole lot like Condon. But boy, has she made a difference. 4 seconds left, shot put up, blocked. Padgett tried to save it, one on the shot clock. Kuchutin out, and Edelyn Bowman in. Well, it's gotta be quick here with 1 second. Catch and release. Oh, it got stuck.
Not quite sure she maybe even got that one off in time. Oh, big play right there by the cameraman coming in, getting the ball unstuck. Better him than you or I, Steve,
yeah.
I think.
If back when I was 18, I could at least touch the rim,
maybe,
but that was a long time ago. Bowman, bounce pass along the baseline, will have a foul on Brandon Valley.
Brandon Valley just defensively, they provide multiple efforts, you know, and it's what you love to see as a coach. They're always engaged in the play, regardless of where that ball is. They get away with putting two defenders on the ball because their other three are always moving into the right position. There's a corner three.
Adeline Bowman, younger sister of Mariah. Her first points of the night. And the lady's a sophomore, gets into the scoring column. Deckert, bounce pass, Kellenberger. Oh, into no woman's land, and that's tapped away, but somehow Brandon Valley ends up with it. Now they don't. It's out of bounds. It is going to go to Spearfish. Minute 40 left. Looks like Brandon Valley has a date with Harrisburg tomorrow night in the semifinals. Bowman, that might have been partially blocked from behind. Giever ends up with it.
Yeah, Kellenberger there coming up top, covering up the high post.
Kellenberger a three, short of the mark, and the rebound to Guthmiller. Bowman with the ball, that's Adeline. Chutin. And she has it taken away by Deckard. Coming up on the 1 minute mark. And looks like Grand Valley wants to maybe back it out, but Spearfish still fighting for that basketball. Now Padgett has it. Under a minute to go. Padgett steps back. She's in no hurry. Why should she be? And we're gonna have a foul on Bowman. That's Mariah Bowman, number 30, and that'll be her fourth. And here come the reserves to the scorers table for Brandon Valley. They're gonna clear the bench. Spearfish also sending a number of reserves to the scorers table. You see it there. Padgett at the line. What a game she has played. 14 points now. We'll try to pick up the subs as they come in. Evie Hoff, number 34. Number 22 is Mallory Babb. Second one in the air. And also coming in is Annika Peterson, number 42 for Brandon Valley. They also have Addison Hunsade in the game. Spearfish will try to pick up their reserves as well here. They've got Sierra West into the contest. Into the paint, it's tapped away. Picked up by Spearfish. Shot up and good by Tiersen Grubb. 21. Shot clock is off. Pass in the backcourt. Babb with the ball. And 10 seconds is the call. One last chance for Spearfish here. London Giever, 5'11 freshman, into the game. Here's a three on the way. It'll be off the mark and picked up by Giever. She'll just hold the ball up, now throw it to the middle of the court. And they're gonna try to fight for it, and we're gonna have a foul. And it's gonna be on Spearfish. And that will be on Maddie Donovan, junior. And going to the free throw line, Mallory Babb. She has not made a free throw all year. She's a 5'5 senior. It's her first free throw attempt of the year. No. The fans for Brandon Valley are cheering for the senior to make this free throw. Yes! Big smile on her face as that will make the final score 58-42. Brandon Valley with a convincing win here in the quarterfinal round of the girls AA basketball tournament. They advance to the semifinals and they will meet Harrisburg tomorrow in our second game. What a game for Brandon Valley. This was a team effort by the Lynx, as they just had so many players contribute offensively and defensively to their winning effort tonight. They jumped out to a lead 15-5 at that end of that first quarter of play. They never really held back. Now Spearfish kind of played them even the rest of the way. Relatively close, but they got out to that big lead, did Spearfish, and they just never could get within striking distance as Brandon Valley pushed him, just kind of held him at arm's length the entire way. Brandon Valley posts the 58-42 victory. For Spearfish, they are now 15-7 on the year. The Lynx, the number three team, number three in the final polls, they are now 18-4. Let's send it down to Nate Kading, who's standing by with the winning coach.
Coach, talk about your effort defensively, both with that full court press and in that half court zone. You really had them uncomfortable for a lot of the night.
You know, it's one of the things we talk about all the time, and we talk about, you know, just creating and handling pressure. You know, when we feel like if we can, you know, kind of be on the positive end of that, that it's going to be a good night. And I give a lot of credit to our girls, you know, especially those top two, and Ava and Liv. Reese Condon's really come on at the end of the year, you know, at the top of that. And they kind of set that tone for us right away out the gate defensively.
Yeah, and you mentioned some of it, but your depth that you're able to play off the bench and just your offensive balance, how important is that going to be here for the rest of the run in the tournament?
It's huge. You know, when you have a bunch of people that feel confident enough to, you know, go score the basketball and, a great facilitator in Olivia Padgett to be able to, you know, be willing to share the basketball, we've got a really unselfish team. You know, it's been a lot of fun to coach them, and really glad to get to do it for a couple more days.
No question, Coach. Hey, thanks for the time. Going to be a fun one tomorrow. Best of luck.
All right, thank you, Nate. Congratulations to Brandon Valley. We'll be back with more after this timeout right here on SDPB3.
Dreamer, doer, difference maker. These are just a few things we look for when growing our team at Dakota Bank. Those with empathy and a commitment to doing what's right build their careers with us. If you're about relationships and helping others, Dakota Bank is calling. Will you answer? Go with integrity. Go with teamwork. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small, just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business, Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
.58-42, that's our final. Brandon Valley prevails over Spearfish in our final game here on day one of the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. Let's check out, Nate, these second half highlights. And Brandon Valley just in the paint, dominated all night long.
Yeah, Liv Pageant, what an impressive night. 15 points, 6 assists, was active on the glass. A lot of things started and stopped with her.
Spearfish trying to rally. That's Mariah Bowman getting the bucket there. And then Salter, what a big night for her off the bench. And she contributed with 4 points, but also 7 rebounds. Dana with a good night for Spearfish, leading them with 14 points. But just too much of that young lady. Padgett, she got blocked that time, but she was distributing the basketball. Kennedy Deckert getting the bucket there. It's a nice inbounds play. That's Adeline Bowman getting the tray late in the game. In that first quarter, Spearfish was down by 10. They never really recovered from that, as Brandon Valley, an even 50% from the floor, 33% for Spearfish. Plus 13 on the glass for Brandon Valley. Turnovers relatively even. Free throws kind of a wash there. Three-pointers kind of a wash too, but Brandon Valley just dominating in the paint, outscoring Spearfish 32-14 in that department. And you talked about those inbounds plays.
Yeah, but yeah, the interior stuff, but anytime they were able to create easy ones, they just did that a lot more than Spearfish was able to. Those uncontested finishes, everything that Spearfish got tonight, they had to work really, really hard for. And it just wasn't that way for Brandon Valley offensively. And when that happens, you end up with the score the way it did here tonight.
And a whole bunch of players contributed to the Brandon Valley winning effort, 58-42. 42. They were impressive, no doubt about it. We'll take a timeout. We'll come back. We'll tell you what's happening tomorrow, day two of the girls AA basketball tournament. Back in a moment, right here on SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Our teams are committed to improving quality of life in our communities. Whether we're planning construction concepts, building a new downtown development, bringing new businesses to our communities, or maintaining your apartment home. We believe everyone deserves a well-built and well-managed place to live and work. This is Lloyd.
Oh my goodness.
You're committed to building relationships, to exceeding expectations, to serving your community. Your financial partner should share your vision and your values. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
I was looking for something that was gonna be close to home.
Southeast Tech has definitely helped me. I'm actually doing something that I enjoy.
This is the right place to be.
Get your degree, get to work at Southeast Tech.
All right, we've finished up our action for today here at the Pentagon in Sioux Falls. Day one in the books. Brandon Valley winning the final contest over Spearfish. So here's what's happened earlier today. O'Gorman in overtime over Stevens. Jefferson holds off a furious comeback by Pier TF Riggs. They will play in the first semifinal tomorrow night. O'Gorman against Jefferson, the nightcap. Harrisburg pulling off the upset over number two Mitchell, 57-41 earlier tonight. They will meet Brandon Valley. Our action will get on the air with the consolation bracket at noon Central Time, 11 a.m. Mountain Time tomorrow. It's Rapid City Stevens taking on Pier. We'll follow that up, Mitchell against Spearfish. Nate, it is great working with you today. Look forward to working with you tomorrow.
Appreciate it, Steve. Thanks for having you on. And semifinal Friday. Doesn't get much better than that. You think we're going to have a decent atmosphere here with four metro area schools tomorrow night?
Get here early if you want to be in person. I got a feeling this place is going to be rocking tomorrow night. You'll see all the action tomorrow here on SDPB3. On behalf of our engineering, operation, and production crew, and for Nate Kading, I'm Steve Toombs signing off from the Pentagon. Here, you've been watching the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on SDPB3. Good night, everybody.